Lights, camera, action.
Hi, everybody. I just gave you a sneak preview. That's Jeff Foster.
Okay.
And Richard Miller here, never not here. Thanks for coming. And let me make sure that everything is going really good, you know. I always want to make sure that we're getting good sound and a good quality video. I'm so pleased that so many people are enthusiastically coming to the show today, and we have a lot of good things to talk about, I think. So anyhow, just let me just put Jeff on and introduce him, and I know many of you have met him before. Jeff, welcome.
Hello. Hello, Richard. Hello, world. Nice to be back.
Yeah. Somebody's already on Skype, I think. Are they or not?
Oh, they're eager.
Yeah. So let's just say a few things because, you know, like yesterday I had called you and we were talking about new languaging.
Mm.
And, you know, why does it seem like a lot of people are not interested in satsang or in, you know, what we have to talk about, talking about life and you know, we're talking about old-fashioned language and stuff that makes it sound like we're a club. And And so that you just said, okay, well, look, I'm thinking of the same lines, and I just wrote a new book. So let's check it out. You can show us your new book. It's called...
Oh, my new book. We're going to plug my new book already.
Right? Let's go right from the start.
Okay, let's just go for it.
An Extraordinary Absence.
Okay.
An Extraordinary Absence. It just hit print about 1 or 2 days ago.
It's called An Extraordinary Absence, Liberation in the Midst of a Very Ordinary Life. And there's a lovely photo of a bench by the sea there. That's taken by my friend Nick. And it's a very ordinary bench when you first look at it. The reason we wanted to do this photo, you see, it's when you first look at it, it's almost like the absence of something, right? It's like an empty bench. But actually, it's not empty at all. It's like a full, present expression of life, and nothing is missing from it. Nothing is missing. So anyway, that's a bit of background.
Yeah.
But yeah, about the language thing. You're right. This kind of non-duality Advaita speak, you know, where you have to say things like "I'm not here all the time" and "there's no one here" and. You know, if you ask someone, I don't know, if they want something to eat, they reply, "No, there's no one here. There's no one here to eat." You know, I mean, it's so what we were saying yesterday, weren't
they
we?
They might just say, "This body, you know, this body, this body's got a little bit of hunger."
Yeah, but this is the thing. Like, so easily, non-duality, Advaita, whatever you want to call it, just becomes another belief system. It just becomes another set of concepts for the individual to latch onto. With this new book especially, I just wanted to completely get away from all of that. You know, I want to get back to what this is really about, which is just the aliveness of everything, you know, the presence of everything. And it's like this, whatever you want to call it, this aliveness, oneness, presence. I mean, it's not about the words, you know. It can't be contained by any particular language, you know. And so easily this all becomes about the language and using the right language. It's like, you know, if you're using the word "I" too much, it means that you don't get this somehow. And it's just like, this isn't about the words. So why not find new ways of expressing this? Why not find new language? Why not meet people like where they are, you know? And that's what's much more interesting to me these days is meeting people where they are. And of course, it's a complete paradox because there's no one there, right? You know, so you're not really meeting anyone. You're not really meeting a separate person, but... I don't know. I think it's time to move away from the old language, you know, find new ways of expressing this because it's in everything. It's as much in the words, "I'm not here" as it is in the words, you know, "fish and chips," you know? So you say "fish and chips" or you say "I'm not here." So that's all I have to say about that.
I can really feel for it because, you know, doing these shows, we get a lot of call-ins and people are so close or they're, You know, there are real, you know, you can see somehow what I'm stuck on, of course, I'm blind to, right? But what other people's are stuck on, it always seems to pop out and be obvious. And even the dichotomy of saying form and formless, right? And we say the formless or pure presence, or many people are saying things like pure awareness. And then the idea is that manifestation comes into, content and manifests in pure awareness. But that makes content separate, you know, and actually content is pure awareness. And how could it be separate?
Exactly. And that's what the word non-duality really points to, you know. It's the awareness, consciousness, whatever you want to call it, isn't separate from its content. The problem with that, that's the place where words completely fail. And the problem is all we appear to have is words, you know, that's what these are, they're words. So, I mean, of course, the most important thing to always remember is that it's not about the bloody words, you know, it's not about the words.
Let's just say we have more than words, because we have words, we have intentions, we have spaciousness, we have seeing and knowing. You know, knowing might be a mental construct, but it also might just be a direct seeing. And we have a heart, you know, we just have love that is kind of rolling out of our body or out of, you know, and those are experiences. Okay. But I mean, you know, all those things, and then we throw a few words in on top of it, right?
Yeah. I mean, the point is, like, what do all those words mean in the face of life as it is? You know, so in the book, I talk about a recent experience I had. I was diagnosed with, I had an abscess growing in my bum. My what do you say in America?
I don't know. That's fanny. Good enough. You know, we got it.
Is it fanny?
We got the picture.
Bum. I'll say bum. You know, I'm kind of lying there in the hospital bed, you know, this intense pain, you know, between my legs. And it's like, you know, this is it too. You know, whatever this is has to include everything. It has to include everything. It has to include that present searing pain between your legs. And so in the face of that, in the face of what's happening, what do all those words mean? I mean, it's almost like you can comfort yourself by telling yourself, oh, it's all a dream, there's no one here, there's no choice, there's no path. It's almost like you can use the non-duality language to comfort yourself, you know, but it's still in the face of life as it is, in the face of reality, you could say, in the face of what's happening, what do all those words and concepts mean? And really, what use are they? What use are they in the face of life as it explodes, you know, as it happens? So that's really what this has always been about for me, is life as it is, you know. And it's just a shame that language appears to be so limited when you're trying to express that. I mean, it's impossible. You know, I mean, when I first started doing my talks, you know, I'd never talked about this in public before. You know, I'd never really spoken to anyone about this. I had never been to any meetings myself, any retreats or anything myself. I never had a teacher. And so when I did my first meeting, you know, the way I expressed it back then was like, this is it. You know, this is it. Those were like, I had very few words to express it. You know, I would say things like, you know, this is it. This is it. There's just no choice in this. There's no one here. There's no path. You see, that was an attempt to express what was being seen here, what was this, you know, as it was being lived. What happened then is that people heard what I was saying and they said, right, Jeff must be a radical Advaita teacher. Jeff must be a radical non-duality teacher, because he's saying things like, this is it. There's no one here. There's no path. And they categorize that as radical non-duality or neo-Advaita, whatever you want to call it. It's like, it's amazing, this need to categorize, you know, this need to categorize is astonishing. And you see, I wasn't attempting to be a neo-Advaita teacher. I was just attempting to put this into words. So
it's just a dead belief, you know, it's in a way, it's just a total belief that somehow explaining things is somehow helpful. And so then the explainer goes on, you know, the explaining machine. And you said comfort yourself, but I mean, in a way, it's just kind of like, this total sureness that somehow if I say it in a different way and I hold that and tell a lot of people that those words that it's gonna somehow get me there.
If I repeat them enough, you know, but what I started to notice, which was fascinating, is what was happening is that I started to meet these people who had, you know, been to non-duality Advaita meetings for maybe their whole lives, and they had taken it on as a belief system. And they would sit there in the meetings, you know, saying things like, well, there's no one here. There's no choice. There's no path. They were, you know, it's like they were absolutely certain. They were certain that there was no person there. They were certain that there was no path. So what I saw, this was an astonishing phenomenon, is that the mind had even latched on to these words. It had latched on to these words and turned it into a new belief system.
In a way, though, that's very touching, you know. For me, that's very touching. Like, that's just so, it's like a beautiful child. But, I mean, it's just like, they just want, you know. There's a desire there, and there's a whole thing like grasping and stuff. But, I mean, I feel a real love. When I maybe it's because I recognize it myself, how many things I've grasped onto and how many things I'm still grasping to.
But that's, I mean, there's a real innocence to it. You know, it's like we know not what we do. If we knew what we were doing to ourselves, if we knew the suffering that we were creating, we just wouldn't do it anymore. The point is we don't know. There's like an innocence to it. And of course, the flip side of innocence is ignorance, like ignorance of this, you know. I mean, innocence and ignorance are very, really two sides of the same coin. All ignorance is innocence, and all innocence is ignorance, really. But it was just fascinating to see how easily this message could be taken on as a new belief system. And it's like these people I met, I was like, my God, these were like miserable, contracted people, really contracted, because they were so certain. They were so certain that they weren't there. And so what I started to see is that it's like, if you do stick to one particular language, if you start to repeat things like there's no one here, no one here, nothing to do, if you start to repeat that as ad nauseum, it what it can do is it kind of fuels that. It does start to sound like a bit of a cult. It does start to sound like a bit of a philosophy, like a religion. That's what it starts to sound like. And it's like it starts to stagnate, you know, because what this is really about is aliveness, life as it is, which cannot be contained by any belief system, by any concept. This can't even be contained by the most beautiful, some of them are beautiful, you know, these non-duality concepts, these Advaita concepts. No concept can touch life. I mean, life, you know, it's the fire that burns up all concepts. And, you know, that fire, you know, a fire doesn't care what it burns up. It will burn up all the concepts. It will burn up the non-duality concepts. It will burn up the concepts of there is choice, or there is no choice, or there is a self, or there is no self. It burns up the opposites, you know. So I guess before we go on, that's a really important thing to say, is that this isn't a new belief system, although it can sound like that. That's the thing; it can sound like that.
But I just got one of those booklets, you know. I don't know from a radical Christian booklet. I guess I got in the mail, you know, resident. So anyhow, you know, it was telling me about all the fear of the end of the world, and how all their predictions are coming true, and how we could just see it here and there and everywhere, and what to do to protect myself and all that stuff. And I just kind of realized that, you know, in a way, these are touching too, you know, but they're the same bondage as believing that all is one and that we're one. It's a concept, you know, and it's the same bondage, right, Jeff? I mean, how can one bondage be a little bit better than another, you know?
That's true. I mean, and the problem with any belief system, you know, whether it's Christian, Jewish, Buddhist, or Advaita, or non-duality, is that it's like the moment you have something, or you think you have something, there must... What arises is fear at the same time, because there's, you know, the moment you have something, you can lose something. And that whether it's a possession, money, a person, or a belief, or an opinion, or a concept, or anything, the moment you have something, you can lose something. And on some level, you must know that. So then, you know, and it becomes such an effort to try and cling on to what you have. I mean, and even, you know, the attempt to cling on to this belief that you're not a person, or that there's no choice, or that, I mean, it was never meant as a belief, that they're pointers. They were always pointers, you know? They were pointers. They were never meant to be taken on as beliefs. The moment you, in a sense, the moment you believe that you're not a person, it's just not true.
It's so great when you say that you're afraid you'll lose something, because a belief is something you could easily lose, because all you gotta have is a doubt. You gotta have a doubt will come in, you know, which is like an upside down, the same thing as a belief standing on its head saying, no, that ain't true. Well, and in the whole realm of doubt and belief, I mean, there's nothing permanent. There's nothing stable. There's nothing that you really know for yourself. And
exactly. Well, you can, you know, the doubt arises, and at the same time, you can forget what you know. That's the problem. You can forget. You have to wake up every morning and remind yourself of what you know on some level. Years ago, it was so funny. I used to really believe that I got this, that I had this, that I used to believe that I was awakened or enlightened. And like, it's like every night I'd go to bed and I was so sure of everything. I knew it all, right? And every morning I'd wake up and it was like, shit, I've forgotten. Then I would have to remind myself of what I knew. It's like anything that you know, you can forget. Anything you know, like number one, you can't know it's true. You can't know it's true. It would have to be a belief. So the moment you have a belief, there must also be doubt. Number two, you can forget what you know. So either way, you're screwed. So, but that's the beauty of it. That is the beauty of life, is that it cannot be contained by any belief, any certainty. Any certainty. So this is really the invitation to move beyond certainty, move beyond what you know. Even your most cherished beliefs about yourself, about who you are. And that's going to be very threatening to the person, you know, to the person who's trying to cling on. And that's why most people in the world are not going to be interested in this, you know, in this radical message. And I don't blame them.
Well, you know, it's threatening to say that there's no ground underneath you, and that all those things that you thought you were, well, you know, we do so many things because we think we're building a structure, you know, and we're building a foundation that where our life is going to rest on. And then when you say, oh, really, all those things you did, you know, it's really good if you study science in college, because by the time you graduate, all that science is outdated, you know, and then you start realizing I build nothing. I just built the flexibility to learn something. And or to be, you know, to be with what is current, I guess, or, you know, I don't know.
And this is, it's important to say as well, this isn't a rejection of knowledge. You know, knowledge is beautiful. It's beautiful. It can be beautiful. This isn't about getting rid of knowledge. Knowledge can stay. Knowledge is allowed to be here. This includes everything. It's just that what's underneath that knowledge, you know, it's that knowledge, it swims in nothingness. As you said, it's groundless. But it actually, ultimately, even that isn't true. You know, it's only groundless from the perspective of the person. Because even that's another concept, right? That nothingness, the nothingness beyond everything, the nothingness, the emptiness beneath everything. Ultimately, there is no nothingness. There is no emptiness. There is no void underneath everything. So a metaphor that I've been using recently that's quite useful, I think. So imagine a balloon. A balloon filled with air, and it's floating in air. It's floating in like an infinite sea of air, right? And the balloon says, you know, I'm a balloon. You know, this is mine. This is me and mine. This is my air. What's inside me? Somehow this is mine. My air. It's like my little piece of everything. You know, my little share of everything. My air. And you know, my thoughts, my opinions, my achievements, my possessions, my past, my future, my knowledge, my seeking, everything. And so, yeah, so this is me and mine. And so what the balloon fears more than anything is the popping. You know, what the balloon fears more than anything is popping, death, because the balloon sees that as the loss of everything. The loss of me and mine. And that's terrifying. The loss of me and mine, because me and mine, that's all you've ever known, right? That's all you've ever known is me and mine. I mean, the cosmic joke actually is what happens upon the popping, death, what happens upon death when the balloon pops? what actually happens, what appears to happen, is my little part of everything, my little share of everything, explodes into everything. And what's seen is that there never was me and mine. There never was my little share of everything separate from everything. There was only ever everything. Like, it was never my air. How could it be my air? There is only air. So it's like there was only... So it's like there's only death from the perspective of the individual. From the perspective of the air, nothing dies. Nothing is lost, because nothing was ever separate from everything. So it's the balloon that says, my God, beyond me and mine, there's nothing. And that's almost the tactic that it uses to keep itself in place. It like terrifies itself with the thought of nothing. It terrifies itself with the threat of emptiness. And it uses that threat to keep itself intact. So actually, Richard, there isn't even any emptiness. Like, where's emptiness? I can't find it. There's just this. Emptiness is just another concept. Emptiness, form, emptiness. That's this again, you know? Form, formless. Emptiness, I mean, it just goes on. And really, there's only everything. There is only everything. And you can't lose everything. You can't lose everything. So the point is, you never had anything. Or more correctly, there was never anyone here who had anything. So actually, on death, nothing is lost, because this was never yours. This was never yours. And that can be seen now. That can be seen now. And of course, that's the only time it can ever be seen, is that none of this is yours. And when it's seen that none of this is yours, you get to play. Then you get to play. It's like, once you're dead, right, the rest is a bonus. This is a bonus. This is what people don't get. This is, my God, this is a bonus. You know, each breath is a bonus. And that's the gratitude. It's like, we don't even deserve this. Like, what have we actually done to deserve this? You know, we are essentially nothing. There's no one here. And yet, we get all of this. We get each breath, each heartbeat, each sensation, each thought. Thought is included. We get webcasts, and internet, and
hooray,
and abscesses in our bums. We get everything is included, right? Oneness has to be everything. How could it not be everything? And so, it's so funny, because, you know, we have so many concepts about what oneness is. It's like, oneness is all the lovely, fluffy stuff. But it couldn't be the abscess. It couldn't be the dog shit on the pavement. Well, of course it is. It has to be everything. And that's the hardest thing to accept, you know, because that's the real death, is seeing that it's everything. And then seeing, of course, that nothing can die, that there's nothing here that can die anyway.
One time you used to, at least I remember you used to say that all your experience is the past, because without the recognition of what you're seeing and experiencing, which comes from like your built up, well, and when you say it's the past, in other words, it seems like it's a function of a mental function, your experience.
Yeah.
Is that what you mean?
Did I say that?
Well, you did say that all
Forget
experience
what I say,
is the
Richard.
Past, you know, meaning that, well, I look, took it I to mean, be that it was from your mind's eye view, you know,
everything
is how did
is
you
past.
Recognize that that's an experience.
I mean, everything is the past in the sense that it's a thought, and thought is always knowledge. Memory. It's all memory. Without memory, you have no way of knowing what this is. Forget about past. You can't even know the present.
Without memory, you can't know the present?
Well, you can't know anything about it.
Yeah, you can't describe it or make any distinctions, right?
So it's like, tell me something about the present. The moment you open your mouth, that's the knowledge. That's the knowledge coming in. And knowledge is always past. It's like, it's past that comes in and even says, this is present. Past says this is present, and then it projects future. So without the knowledge, you can't even know that this is present.
There's certainly nothing to say about it. I mean,
nothing
of course,
to say about,
you know,
that, is there?
Yeah. But I mean, I just wanted to make that distinction, because, you know, like all the content in our lives and all the stories that we tell ourselves, which seems to be our separate life, all our stories of separateness and so on, is this content-based part of our life, which seems to go on even in those that are even in those high gurus that are living on thin air, you know, the breatharians or something like that. Still, they got an experience, right? And
It's just people telling different stories, right? It's just the stories we tell. Without the stories about my life and my experiences and my achievements and my wonderful enlightenment or whatever, or my breatharian practices, whatever. Without the stories, what is this? That's what it's all about. Without the stories, you have no way of knowing what this is. Until it's like prior to the story that you are a person sitting on a chair in a room. Prior to that story, you have absolutely no way of knowing what this is. It's just the cosmic mystery. It's the absolute mystery. And out of the mystery arises I, you know, I. And that's where it all begins. And the moment you have I, you have world. I and world always arise together. And prior to that contraction, you should call it, you have no way of knowing what this is. And it's like you meet it for the first time. And it's like there's only this presence. There is only this presence. And everything happens in this presence. All the most wonderful, complicated stories about our lives and our achievements and past and future and our seeking, our regret, our guilt, our anxiety. It's like a giant bundle of stories appearing here. It always appears here. Just a big bundle of stories appearing. And this isn't about getting rid of the bundle. I'm not suggesting getting rid of the bundle.
Well, we couldn't. That's just what I'm driving at. Exactly. You know? Like, I mean, it would be just a black hole, wouldn't it, if we got rid of the bundle?
The point is, there's no one there who can get rid of the bundle. You are the bundle. So without the bundle, we can't even say there's a black hole, because there's no one there who could. That would be another concept. That would be part of the bundle. The black hole goes in with the bundle.
Right.
You stick everything in the bundle.
No, but what I'm saying is, like, with the old languaging, or, you know, if there is such a thing. But I'm just saying that a lot of times the teaching is taken in such a way that there's the form and the formless. Okay, that there's the pure presence or pure awareness, and then there's manifestation or content. And then in the beginning, we were saying, okay, well, how can that be? It's just got to be the content is pure awareness. But I mean, what I'm saying is this kind of a teaching sets up a preference, or it says, like, shouldn't I be hanging out in pure awareness and not hanging out in content, you know? And getting that it's the same thing, no. You know, that there's no preference, because the preference just kind of likes means something to reject and something to grasp for. And the grasping is all of suffering. Yeah. I don't know.
So Ramana Maharshi, he said, that lovely quote, I think it was Ramana Maharshi. Maybe he was quoting someone else, but it was, you know, the world is illusory. Brahman alone is real. Brahman is the world. On some level, you know, you begin by recognizing that in some way the world is a problem. The world of passing form is a problem. You know, it's impermanent. It's impermanent. Everything's impermanent. So, you know, there can be, my God, everything's impermanent. So I need to find something permanent behind the impermanent. So then we might get attracted to these spiritual teachings, you know, that tell us to abide in aware, find the awareness behind the world, find the awareness behind content, find the emptiness, find the peaceful presence behind everything and dwell there. And that, you know what, that's, and that can be really helpful to a person who's looking for peace, you know. And I know in years ago, you know, my life had become such a misery that, you know, thank God that I found these books that taught me to be present, that taught me to find the presence, find the awareness, you know, pull back into awareness, because, you know, my life as it was, you know, had become an absolute hell, and it had become unlivable. And, you know, it was an amazing discovery at the time, you know, to find this peaceful place, this peaceful place devoid of content, behind the world, of suffering, behind the world of impermanence. And it, at the time, it felt very peaceful. It felt very, it was a relief. It was a massive relief. And for a while, I dwelt in the emptiness. But of course, you know what I couldn't see back then was that it's like there was still someone there separate from life, you know. And you're right, it was a subtle rejection or denial of, well, actually I wouldn't say subtle at all, it was a rejection, it was a denial of form, it was a denial of content. It's like there was still someone there doing that rejection, although at the time, this was back then, that's when I thought that I was enlightened, because I was dwelling in the formless, you know, stabilized, whatever you want to call it, in the absolute. But, you know, if I'm honest, it was a very dull, dead place. Well, that's what it became anyway. It was, yes, it was very peaceful, but it was very detached. It was very detached. And I think a lot of people get stuck there. And this is, you know, I quoted Ramana Maharshi before. The world is illusory. Brahman alone is real. So there's a recognition that, you know, the world is illusory. So I'm going to pull back into Brahman, into the absolute, into awareness, into the emptiness, into the void. I mean, there's so many words, you know, and I'm going to dwell there because that's what I think non-duality is all about. I'll dwell there in the I'm no one, nothing happening. No this, no that, no choice, no this, nothing. And that's only half the story. That's only half the story. And as the third part is, Brahman is the world. It is the world. That formless, the emptiness, that it is the world. Awareness is contents of awareness. Consciousness is everything. So
Brahman is the world. It means Brahman is form, too. Brahman is form.
Exactly.
Actually.
So,
yeah.
What does that mean? I mean, that's that could become another fancy belief system, that emptiness is form, awareness is contents of awareness. So we could go around believing that. What does it mean? What's it pointing to? I'll tell you what it's pointing to. It's pointing to this.
It just means nothing is to be rejected.
Exactly.
Nothing is preferred. Whatever comes before
life
our
as
eyes
it is.
Somehow
it
is to be.
It is life as it is. This is the greatest spiritual experience of my life, having this cup of coffee. You know, life as it is the miracle. That's what all these damn words are pointing to. We can get so lost in the philosophy of it. And, you know, a lot of people, you know, send me emails and it's like, Jeff, your message, it's too simplistic. It's too simple. It's too simple. Oh, yeah, it's too simple.
You mean you're not even going to apologize for that?
No, why would I apologize for having a cup of coffee?
No, for having such a simple teaching.
But you know what? That simplicity is deadly. It's very threatening to the person. To the person, that simplicity is a kind of death. It's like, what? You mean this is it? How can this be it? I've spent 20, 30, 40, 50 years seeking. Are you telling me that it's just this? I can't accept. They can't accept that. To fully accept that would be death. Death of the seeker. And it's like, if you're so attached to your identity, to your spiritual identity, you know, if you think of yourself as I'm a spiritual person. I'm a spiritual seeker. That's what I am. Then yeah, this message is going to really threaten that identity. Really threaten that identity. I mean, in a way, you know, having a cup of coffee, the simplicity of that is the most threatening thing in the world to a spiritual seeker, because they want something more. They want something more than this, more than this absolute simplicity, more than the absolute simplicity of what's happening, or less, more or less, same movement. They want something else. They want to find the emptiness. They want to transcend their self, or, I don't know, get rid of thought. Or, I mean, there's a million different.
Well, when you say like attached to being a seeker, you know, it's just something about when you believe your life is, in a way, is a business and every investment has to pay off. Okay, I did a year doing this. I did a year doing that. I went to dental school. Now I'm a dentist. I have to be a dentist for at least 30 years to pay, you know, to make that worthwhile. Okay, I've been a seeker for 20 years. I've learned this meditation so well. Somehow it has to integrate into my life and pay off. It's not something I can discard. And so then, like, we're a lot of little pack rats that are just building up all our credentials and all our experiences and saying, my God, please let all these things point to something. Let all these things that I've wasted my time on, you know, be somehow of value, you know. And it's really, like it's just the, you know, it's not, it's the whole thing of saying that life is a destination and not saying life is a journey, you know, that each journey, that each thing you pick up, you put back down and then pick up something new tomorrow, you know. And I don't know. I've gone in like 10-year spurts, you know, like where I would collect and then I would ditch everything, you know, and then at least I haven't gone 30 years, you know, but I don't know. Because like when you get a house, you know, like your parents' house, they've been there 30 years. The basement is just chock full of crap, you know.
But again, it's the same thing I was saying earlier. It's the fear of losing what you have, losing what you've built up. You know, you've
it's
built
value.
Up 20,
it's a valuation value. Of saying that all that stuff must be golden because I spent years touching it and fooling with it and being fooled by it, really.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like we want a result. We've put in the effort. We want a result. It's like we think, and that mechanism is very useful, apparently, in the world. Like if you want to learn French, you put in the effort and, you know, you go to classes every week for a year and you get a result. You know, if you want to learn... We're doing like a mathematical problem. You put in the effort, you get a result. And we think that we can use that same mechanism to reach this. Not going to happen. So in a way, this is about massive disappointment. You know, to the mind. The, you know, the mind, the person, whatever you want to call it, the ego, hears that this is it. It's like, shit, you mean... This is it? You know, I expected something so much more, so much bigger than this, so much more spiritual than this. This is too ordinary, you know. And so the mind says, this is a massive disappointment. This is a massive, what a failure. The mind even might say, God, what a massive failure I am. I've failed.
Let's talk to those people that have had really marvelous spiritual experiences, because you have too, you know, and so that you would be a perfect one to talk about that. But, you know, I've known so many people that are luckily, I think I'm really lucky that I haven't had any big whoppers, you know, and so that
big whoppers.
A lot of people that are stuck on like 20, 30 years ago. I was so clear. I know that is what life is made of, you know, and now is not it, you know, it is just not it.
And spiritual, again, this isn't a rejection of any experience. You know, this world, an apparent world, whatever you want to call it, this dream world, whatever you want to call it, it's a playground, right? And like, go out, have these experiences, have a million different experiences, have the most mind-blowing spiritual experiences. Wonderful, but they're going to come and go. Even the most mind-blowing spiritual experience, it's going to come and go. You say, so you had the most mind-blowing spiritual experience of your life 5 minutes ago. Okay, wonderful, it's gone. What's left? This is very ordinary. But then, of course, you can't even call it ordinary, you know, because I always say this, you know, it was always the search for the extraordinary, which is really the spiritual search, you could say, you know, it was always the search for the extraordinary that made this ordinary. You know, it made having a cup of coffee, actually, it's empty now, it made having a cup of coffee ordinary. So we called this moment, you know, we called the... Just the simplicity and obviousness of what's happening. We call this ordinary. Oh, this is ordinary. I want the extraordinary. And it's like then we got so bored with the ordinary. That's when we turned to our teachers and teachings, because they promised something extraordinary, something more than just the simplicity of this. But the thing is, you know, and so that's great. So you go off and you have all these extraordinary experiences. Wonderful. But they're going to come and they're going to go in this dream world of time and space. Everything apparently comes and goes. So what's left? You know, what's left? And then when that search for the extraordinary falls away, you have no way of calling this ordinary ordinary is always in opposition to extraordinary. So how can you call this? How can you call this ordinary? How can you call having a cup of coffee ordinary? How can you call sitting on a chair ordinary? How can you call breathing ordinary? How can you call present, the present appearance of everything, ordinary? How can you call everything ordinary?
It's just great what you said, because like boredom is just a thought, you know, based on reading a few books and stuff like that. And so then that thought brings this feeling of restlessness, you know, saying I should be doing something.
Boredom is, you know, I should be somewhere else. I should be doing something more interesting. I should be doing something more interesting than this. There is something more interesting I could be doing. But it's like when seen in clarity, you know, that actually this is pretty fascinating. Just having a cup of coffee, or I don't know, sitting on the toilet, or just going to, I love going to the supermarket and just walking around the aisles. It's fascinating. What the world calls ordinary, actually seen in clarity, it's pretty damn amazing, you know. And it's like, it's always been here, you know. We never lost this. This has always been here. This chair, the chair that you're sitting on, you know, maybe you spent your life searching for something more than the chair, searching for awakening, searching for enlightenment. Finally, when that seeking falls away, finally that there can just be a sitting on the chair, you know, and it can be fascinating. It's like falling in love with life as it is. I mean, I know that could sound quite corny, but it's not. There's something very real about that, very true about that. You know, it's falling in love with everything. Falling in love with everything, and actually coming to see that there's something here that has always been in love with everything. There's something here that has always been in love with everything. Well, of course it has, because it's never been separate from everything. And that's what the word love really points to, is to me anyway, the word love is just another pointer to the end of separation, the absence of separation. So this is already in love with everything, because it already is everything. You know, this is already in love with sitting on a chair. This is already in love with breathing. This is already in love with having a cup of coffee. This is in love with talking to someone called Richard Miller.
Talking to Richard Miller, I think someone's on Skype. Let's see what we got here and see. Hello, do you hear us on Skype?
I hear you. Do you hear me?
Yes, we do. What's your name and where you're calling from?
My name is Alex, calling from San Diego.
Hi, Alex. Thanks for the call.
Hi, Alex.
Hey, how you doing?
Hey, I'm well, thank you. How are you?
I'm good. Hey, here's something related to what all of you, what you've been talking about so far. I'd like to see if I can get some clarity. With the idea, okay, there's no one doing anything. So when it appears to me, the one that I think I am, that I'm making a decision and then I'm carrying it out, that is an illusion. Am I saying that right?
Yeah, I mean, so imagine this is a great metaphor example. So imagine you're walking down the street and hello, I can see you now. Hello, Alex. So you're walking down the street and there appears to be a fork in the road in front of you. There's a junction, and it looks like you can go left or you can go right. So you say to yourself, okay, I'm going to decide to go left. And you go left and you go, great, I decided to go left. And then you look back and you say, okay, I went left. So it's like if you rewind that movie and play it back without the soundtrack, without the commentary of thought, without the soundtrack that says, I'm choosing, I'm choosing, I'm choosing, I'm choosing, I'm choosing. And you play that back. What you see is just a pair of legs walking down the street and they go left. And the thing is, they don't even know that they're going left. The legs don't know that they're going left. That's only in the thought story, you know. So it's always in the thought story that we appear to choose. So you're absolutely right. We appear to choose. That's part of the play. That's the dream. And actually, to say that there is no choice isn't strictly true either. It's like it can't actually be captured by either of the opposites, by there is no choice or there is choice. It's like there appears to be choice. So it's like in a dream. So say in a dream at night, you maybe in the dream you check your email and there's an email about, you know, Jeff Foster's doing a webcast, and then one day, and then in the dream you find yourself logging onto Skype and you find yourself calling Jeff Foster and asking Jeff Foster a question or whatever, and then you wake up from the dream. And it's like, because it's a dream, you can either say, so you can say it in two ways. You can say, I chose to attend this webcast. You can say, I got the invitation, then I chose to get onto the computer at a certain time, and I chose to Skype in, and I chose to ask the question. Or you could tell the opposite story. You could say that there was no choice. You know, you could say that, but because it was a dream, you could also say it just happened. You could say that there was no choice in it, that this it had to happen this way, that you were brought here, that you were brought here, you know, that. So it's like choice and no choice are still both just stories. That what this is beyond both. This is beyond both, you know. And that's the exciting thing, is that you don't even need to understand that. If you understood this, you know, you'd just be a person with some concepts. You would be a person who had collected some concepts about choice or lack of choice. I mean, so the whole thing always ends in just the mystery of it. Choice or no choice. Look, I can apparently lift that up. And of course, that would be a story told now. You know, Jeff lifted up the mug. Jeff lifted up the mug. Without that story, there's just this. There's just this. So this is beyond choice or lack of choice.
Okay, I mean, I see in that you can't go to either extreme, but in my day-to-day life, here's an issue that I deal with, that we were talking about experiences, ordinary and extraordinary. Now, I have had a lot of what I term extraordinary experiences by doing drugs.
Yeah.
And then, like you said, you know, it's there and then it's gone, obviously. Now, one thing that I like to do is smoke pot. And so I also have thoughts that say, well, I should stop smoking pot. I've been smoking it for a long, long time. I did stop once for several years, so I know it can be done. But then it seems like after several years of not smoking, I decided, you know, I think I want to try smoking again. You know, I tried not doing it, but I like it better when I'm high. So I started smoking again, and I do, it's like, and I enjoy it. And it's like, the feelings that come with that, I guess I'm not satisfied with how I feel before I smoke it. So I smoke it and I feel different. And it seems like I made a decision to smoke it, and then there's the thought I should decide not to smoke it. But when I say that, then maybe I'll wait all day and I'll smoke some in the evening. You know, it's like it's like in the back of my mind, I know sooner or later I'm going to smoke again, even if I say I'm not. So all this decisioning is going back and forth in my mind. And what happens is I pick up some pot and I smoke it, or pot is smoked. Now, can I stop or can I stop? Or is there
a
reason to stop? Or to think I should stop?
Yeah, and you know, absolutely, you could drive yourself mad with all of this. You really could. And I mean, the first thing I want to say is I'm not here to tell you how to live. You know, I'm not here to tell you whether you should or shouldn't smoke pot.
Okay? Well, yeah, should is a bad word. I mean, just having clarity in my own life on seeing this in a more realistic way than I'm obviously seeing it.
Okay, so let's imagine that this is pot. You know, so this is, so my equivalent of smoking pot is drinking coffee. Let's say so. So what's real is coffee is drunk or not. Okay. Coffee is drunk or not. The rest is the thought story. So I shouldn't drink this. You know, I need to drink this. I have choice over this. I don't have choice over this. I need to decide whether to drink coffee or not. So either way, whatever the thought story is, this happens or not. Okay. So, so the story that I have choice over this is a story. The story that I have no choice over this is a story. Okay. You'll drive yourself mad trying to work out if you can choose, if you have choice, if there is choice or not. What I notice is that coffee gets drunk or not. Okay. So I mean, it's that simple.
Can't we just say that choice is a thought? And so then, just like I'm a thought, Richard Miller's a thought, a series of a bundle. It's part of the bundle, isn't it? Where we were talking about the bundle. Choice is a, and so the whole idea that there's choice, that belongs in the bundle, and you know, you can live like that.
So let's look at the myth that you have to choose. I mean, this is a good one. This is something that I have to choose. Okay. Actually, it's interesting that you know the word decide. I have to decide. The word decide literally means to cut off. Decide, cut off. So what you're saying when you say I need to choose, I need to decide, what you're really saying is I need to cut off something. I need to cut off a possibility. Out of the whole of being, I need to cut off one part of being and put it aside. Reject one part of being. A decision is essentially a rejection. Okay. So I'll give an example. I was talking to my girlfriend the other day, and we were talking about she doesn't like the job that she's in. I mean, well, I probably shouldn't say this on national. Okay, so never mind. So she doesn't like the job that she's in, and she
just got her fired.
I did. Well, that's probably a good thing, you know. She wants to leave anyway, but she was saying that recently she's been getting these signs. You know, life has been giving her these signs that it's time to move on. Like, you know, that she didn't get paid properly the last week, and that her boss was really nasty to her. And she was like, these are signs that maybe I should leave my job. You know, and it's like she thought she needed to decide. She thought this was something that she needed to decide. She needed to choose. So it's interesting this you know, when we start to see signs, this is interesting that you know, like she like the fact that she hadn't been paid properly the previous week, she took this as a sign that it was time to leave. Now the only reason that she saw this as a sign is because on some level she had already chosen to leave her job. She had already, the choice had already been made. That's the only reason that she could see signs in the first place. Because if she hadn't already decided, if she, say, was enjoying her job, if she was enjoying smoking pot, in your case, then there wouldn't be any signs that she should quit, you see. That not getting paid would just be something that she would deal with. It wouldn't be a sign of something else. The fact that she was starting to see these signs everywhere, and that the fact that she was even, she was seeing these signs everywhere, and she was driving herself mad because she thought that she needed to decide whether to leave or not. This shows that the choice on some level had already been made, that the choice to leave her job had already been made. And that made things a hell of a lot simpler. Then all it was a case of putting that into motion. It was a case of getting rid of that which appeared to block that course of action, because that course of action had already been decided. It wasn't that she was driving herself mad with, you know, trying to work out whether it was something she needed to decide or not. Actually, what that was doing was blocking any action. There was just stagnation there. You know, all these thoughts of, is there choice, is there no, they swim around. All they do is they just stagnate. You end up just being completely stagnated. And that's when you probably end up smoking pot to get, you know, to loosen things up. So it can be a vicious circle, but just to see that I mean, the very fact that, I mean, I'm not telling you what to do. The very fact that you've called into this show, you see, and you've talked about quitting smoking pot. Maybe that's something you could look into. Is that perhaps a sign that decision has already been made? And ultimately, you see, that's another way of looking at it. That's why there's really never any choice. We're never actually choosing anything. All we're doing is noticing that the choice has been made already. Because otherwise, we wouldn't be doing what we're doing. Otherwise, you probably wouldn't have called
in. When you say the choice has been made, it's not being made by the conscious mind.
No, exactly. No. And this is. I mean, this is language again. It's like, ultimately, no one decides. But I mean, what we're talking in the dream world here. You know, we're talking about in the dream world of apparent choice. You see. So all I'm saying is that, say in the case of my girlfriend, all these signs were popping up that it was perhaps time to leave her job. But it was only because these signs were appearing in her dream, because this is all in your dream, right? It's only because these signs were appearing in her dream that those signs were a manifestation of those signs were that choice having been made. I'm not sure if I'm making myself clear.
I get it. I really get it because, you know, I remember times when I decided to stop alcohol or stop coffee or this or that. And, you know, like it took me 5 years to really put it into action. You know, like I would just say, I know I don't like this stuff, you know, and I'll just try some more, you know. And but, you know, to change the subject just a little, I would like to talk a little bit about or ask you, Jeff, you know, about using substances, which, you know, could be marijuana, but could be other things too. And also using so-called spiritual substances, you know, like ecstasy or ayahuasca or something like that. And really, what are we getting, you know, because in a way, what's happening is an experience is coming to us through feelings in the body, you know. Mm-hmm. So somehow there's feelings in the body. It's interpreted as some kind of a dullness or an emotional something like that. And I know a little bit about drugs. I mean, you know, you don't feel anything. You feel great, you know, like I go out and do a bicycle race or something like that. And the sky's the limit. And so then the instrument of our body, we're putting it aside because we're saying, it's really boring to live in this body, you know, like it keeps giving me these signs that I don't want. And so we've kind of solved it. We've, you know, we've solved the conundrum. We've just figured out how to cut the body off. You know, let's just take something and it'll get us where we want to go. You know, it's the whole idea is that get the hell out of here. And, you know, what are we giving up when we give up our body? You know, this connection, this, you know, we're not totally giving it up, of course, but in a way, I always used to think that it was even better, you know, that the body was much more capable and able and smoke pot and do all kinds of wild things, climb mountains and ski down hills and do things that are just I would never do with my normal body, you know, but that one feeling of like all my aches and pains were gone. And I think then I start to think more and more like I want to be different. I want to be separate. I want to be higher. I want to have a big experience. I want to have a better experience, you know. Then I start to go to spiritual teachers and gurus and stuff and just say, well, you know, where is it, you know, farther and farther away from myself, farther and farther and farther, you know. Yeah. It just seems like it's just there's no end to it, you know. It just it ends in death, basically, and with no finding whatsoever.
But you know, it's all really what the whole thing is. It's the search for home, you know. And we'll use drugs, we'll use sex, we'll use meditation. We'll use anything to try. It's like to get rid of this. And drugs for some people, yeah, give them like a taste of this. But of course, there's always the side effects.
There's stories, you know. A lot of actually teachers that are now spiritual teachers were drug users. Of course, there's the old stories of Timothy Leary and Ram Dass and those guys, LSD guys, you know. And then there's other guys that say, oh yeah, I know a lot about peyote buttons, or somebody else knows about ayahuasca or this or that. And in a way, it's sending a lot of people down these trails, I think, that say, oh, my God, we can have a really again, good experience.
And you know, some people do, you know, in whilst they're high, do have some glimpses of what we're talking about, glimpses of oneness. And the problem is it can become a real addiction, because then you start to use the drug
What's the use of a glimpse of oneness? Just tell me that. Is there any use to it whatsoever?
Well, I mean, apparently for the person, it can be a experience, you know. But I mean, what's
I mean, I would say that for me, it changed, or it's like that glimpse changed my life in that I was not totally involved in the story. I mean, I couldn't really believe it totally anymore. There was like a little lingering in the background, knowing that this story isn't the ultimate reality.
But isn't it just another story, Alex? It's another story. You traded in an old story for a new one. Now you're high and you feel free, you know. But I mean, what's different about it? Well, it's the same bondage, isn't it?
The first experience, let's say, was that pure experience. But then, like you say, coming down from it and then wanting it again becomes a thing that the person desires. The first time it happened, it happened, but I didn't know that was going to happen, and it blew my mind that it happened, and then I wanted it more, and that's when it became part of the story. But that one glimpse, it changed the story, let's say, from this guy who just went to work and believed in everything that he was taught as he grew up, to a guy who kept doing that, but also knew that there was more. You know, that was
so the invitation is to find that within this ordinary experience, within this ordinary consciousness. That's you know, and that's something that doesn't come and go. And that's something that has no side effects. There's no side effects to presence. Right. You know, I'm not telling you. I wouldn't ever tell anyone how to live. I'm not telling you to stop taking drugs, or you're not a child. You know, you don't need to be told how to live. But the invitation is, you know, that ordinary. Look, put it this way: ordinary consciousness is infinitely fascinating. It really is. It really is. And that's the invitation. Just sitting on a chair. You know, you don't need drugs. You don't need drugs. I mean, I used to drink a lot. And it was, you know, when I was drunk, sometimes I felt totally free, you know, because for a while this was silenced. But then of course there's the side effects, there's the hangovers, there's the vomiting, it's unpleasant, you know, I mean, these days I just find this ordinary awareness, just sounds happening, breathing happening, just talking to you or drinking a cup, that's more fascinating than any bloody drug-induced experience, you know. And that, and anyway, as
we're calling these things ordinary experiences, but just like you said before, they're extraordinary. You know, being alive is extraordinary. And anything you do that drives life into dullness and into boredom is like really a left turn in my book. I don't know. I mean, you could just see you're getting farther and farther away, and that the more you skydive and bungee jump and stuff like that, I mean, the more you have to outdo it the next time. There's no way that you're wrecking your life and the gift. I mean, spitting on the gift that you've been given, right?
Yeah.
I don't know. That's I see it.
Well, I mean, I don't know. I don't want to judge anyone or anything, but you know, a lot of people who come to my meetings have had experiences with drugs, and a lot of people do have you could say genuine glimpses of this whilst in the middle of a drug experience or whilst on or something. I mean, of course, once you start, the danger is starting to use drugs, use alcohol, or even use meditation, because that can become equally violent to the body as well. You're using that to get here, because this isn't a destination. It's not a destination. I mean, it's like, it's very similar. A lot of people who come to my meetings talk about, you know, they've had this, they say that they've had this glimpse of oneness, and it lasted maybe a few moments. Well, it's timeless anyway, so you can't even say it lasts a few moments, but let's say they had this glimpse of oneness, and then they say that they lost it, you know, they were in it, and sometimes it, you know, it was in the middle of meditating, they had a glimpse, or it was in the middle of a drug experience, or it was just out walking in the street, walking in the park, or it was, anywhere. I mean, it can happen anywhere, right? Of course. And they this glimpse, and then what happens is they apparently lose it. Because like, it's like the mind comes back in. You know, the person comes back in, and the person says, I had it, and I lost it. I had it, and I lost it, and now I want it back. How can I get it back? And then it's like, well, if I if I apparently had that glimpse during meditation, right, I need to meditate more. Or they say, if I had that glimpse during a drug experience, right, more drugs, you know. But the point is, and this is the thing, the point is, you never had it. You never had it. It was nothing to do with you. If it was anything, it was the falling away of you. And then what happens is that you come back in, the person comes back in and tries to claim that as an experience. I mean, it's only once the person has come back in that you can even begin to call it an experience, because an experience always happens in time, and the person operates in time and space. So that's the only way that this can comprehend, even begin to comprehend it. I mean, it's desperate. It's like, I need to understand this. Right. I'll understand it in terms of time and space. That's the only way it can understand it. So it says, I had a glimpse. I had an experience. That's not even true. That's not even true.
The story with your girlfriend and the job and the decision already being made, that kind of brought some clarity. And I really appreciate that, because that's what I was intending, or that's what happened, I guess.
And remember, the word decision means to cut off. Why would you want to decide? Why would you want to cut off anything, right? And the other interesting thing, I mean, I love words and looking at the origin of words. The word choice is interesting as well. The word choice, the root of the word, it has the same root as the word taste. So it's like we think we're choosing. We're never actually choosing. We're only tasting. We're only ever tasting different possibilities. Because when you say I need to choose, it sounds like something final, right? It's like I need to make a choice, left or right. And it's always like, I need to make this choice and cut off all the other choices. Actually, that never happens. There's no such thing. All we're ever doing is tasting. We're tasting different flavors, different experiences, different sounds and smells. This is like an adventure playground, this world, right? We're children. We're tasting everything. That's the miracle. We get to taste. So you even get to taste pop. You get to taste meditation. You get to taste coffee. You get to taste everything. And so you don't even need to decide to give it up. And what you might find is that you're no longer taking pot. I don't know. But you might wake up one day and there's no interest in it anymore. I mean, it's the same thing that happened with me with spiritual practices. I mean, I was, you know, obsessed with meditation. I mean, it's really that was my drug. You know, yours is pot, mine was meditation. And you know, and then what I found is it fell away when it was ready. And that's the freedom as well. That's just this is out of your control. But remember, it's not about you believing that there's nothing you can do, because that becomes another trap, you know, in the face of, because that can become a very depressing belief. Oh, there's nothing I can do. You know, that's not it either. This is about a seeing this, you know, in clarity.
Well, thank you very much. I'm going to go around and be tasting.
Go and taste.
Instead of getting caught up, I'll just taste.
Happy tasting.
I like that image. Thank you.
Yeah. That's all we're
Thanks
doing
a lot, Alex. Thanks for your call. I think those are really important subjects that we talked about.
Thank you, Richard.
How's life going in Korea?
I'm good. I just got back from India. And that was good. I went to Pune, to the Osho place. So it was a really good time.
This is Glenn from Korea.
Hello.
Hey.
Annyeong haseyo from Korea.
Hey, hello from Korea.
I'm not Korean, though.
You're not?
No. Hey, I wanted to ask a question. I'll try to make it as short as possible.
Yeah.
You were saying at one point you were trying to hang out in the nothingness. And, you know, I did a lot of satsang, and I see a lot of people get there. And what I wanted to ask you a question about is, from there, to get more into content, actually spiritual practice has brought me more into that place that you were talking about. So I always find it funny, I talked to Richard about it, that people start saying, well, don't meditate anymore and there's nothing to do. But yeah. For me, I actually buy doing practices and body work and meditation. Like I just came back from the Osho place. And most people say, well, we graduated from that place. Now we're in satsang. But when I go there now, my depth of being like in the world and feeling this as a full experience gets so much deeper. So I have the opposite experience of what most people tend to talk about in satsang. So I always find it interesting when people are saying, well, there's nothing to do. And so my question is, what can you do to increase or, I guess, get rid of that boundaries that limit people from it having this full experience where drinking a cup of coffee, as you say, is very deep, you know? So is there anything you can do?
Well, I mean, to start with, I've never said don't practice. I've never said that, and I would never say that. I would never never tell people what to do. And it's like, I mean, practices are beautiful. There's some gorgeous practices, beautiful practices. Meditation. I mean, my God, you know, meditation helped me so much. You know, I mean, the way I usually say it is, it's like this dream world is in perfect balance. So, as long as there's someone here who wants a more peaceful mind, you know, within your dream, the meditation, the practices appear to meet you in your dream exactly where you are. You know, it's like you're given exactly what you need. So when there was someone here who wanted a more peaceful mind, what appeared in the dream were the meditation practices, and it's like it's a perfect reflection. It's a perfect reflection. And so you always see your own reflection. You know, your world is always a perfect reflection of you, and you know, and okay, so really, really simple example. You know, a depressed person sees a depressing world. A depressed character sees a depressing world wherever they go. A fearful person, someone who is full of fear, a fearful character sees a terrifying world wherever they go. It's always a perfect reflection. A spiritual person, you know, someone who has identified themselves as a spiritual seeker, you could say, sees a world full of teachers and teachings and practices and methods, and that's wonderful, and that's how it has to be. And I would never tell anyone not to practice. The reason I don't give out specific practices, because I don't know what's best for you. You see, I don't see myself as a teacher, and I don't, you know, there's plenty of people out there who teach practices, and it's like they will appear in your dream when you need them. I don't know what's best for you. Everyone has the practice they need, put it that way. And for some people, it won't be necessarily a spiritual practice. For some people don't appear to need spiritual practices. You know, for some people, this, what we're talking about, can be seen without the meditation. It can be seen in the middle of, you know, walking through a park or you know, living an ordinary life. So I don't give out specific practice. Of course, I, you know, if people come to see me on individually, I might give them something to do. I think the work of Byron Katie is amazing, you know. And like, so when my mum, you know, when my mum comes up to me and she has problems, issues, I don't sit there and telling her there's no practice, you know, there's nothing to do, there's no suffering. No, I help her. But that's like,
seems to be like, if you listen to satsang teachers, that comes out of their mouth a lot. Like you've said it like quite a lot today. Well, it gives off the illusion that meditating and practices are going farther away from this. And I think there's some people that actually do use those as escapisms, you know?
Yeah.
But I think there's other people that kind of actually use them to get more in, not to get a piece
of
mind.
I guess, couldn't we say this, Jeff, that like every practice should be designed to sooner or later become obsolete? Because why should a practice be like breathing that you have to do it your whole life? And if the practice doesn't give you freedom, if it gives you bondage, if a practice is like an albatross and you have to wear it around your neck, I mean, for some reason, maybe because you're escaping and maybe because you love that escaping or because it's the only place where you have peace and you're saying, like, my world is too turmoil. But, I mean, somehow that every practice and every guru and every teacher has to kind of disintegrate and be eventually obsolete, or otherwise what's the point?
Well, this is what the way I sometimes say it as well is, you know, the reason practices appear to work is because ultimately they fail. Because ultimately what can be seen in the midst of practice is that there is no one there doing the practice. And it can be seen in the midst of meditation. That's why I would never reject meditation. But what can be, and that's what happened. I used to meditate 6-7 hours a day. And I had this concept, you see, that Jeff sitting down to meditate was somehow higher, better than Jeff sitting down watching television or drinking a cup of coffee. Now, what was seen in the midst of meditation is that, you see, there is something here that is already complete. This is already complete. There's something here that doesn't need to meditate. It's like it's already meditating. It's constantly meditating.
How do you explain, like for instance, when I'm in Pune, the not meditating, not doing anything, that this awareness of everything just being is just so much more clear. So without any practice, how do you explain those things? You know, obviously.
Yeah, that's a really good question. It's like what they call in Pune the Buddha field. You know, what is this field and what is this state of presence that you can immerse yourself in that other people seem to be
But here's the thing: it's not this presence isn't fixed any particular location. I'm saying it's everywhere. It's right here. You don't have to go to. There's nothing wrong with going to Pune. It's beautiful. But what I'm
why is it so much stronger there? Like. So
well, you see, this is a really, really good question. So, I'll tell you this story. It's quite interesting. So about a year ago, I went with some friends to visit a crop circle. You know crop circles. You know, in the fields. So we were walking through this crop circle. It was beautiful. And this guy comes up to us, and he was really excited, and he said that, oh, wow, you know, do you feel the energy? Do you feel the energy of the crop circle? And I said, no, not really. But he was saying to me, you know, oh, wow, I slept here last night. I slept in the field, and the alien energy was coming into my body, and I, you know, I was shaking and I was crying, and it had like a real physical effect on him. You know, that was his experience, is that the energy from the crop circle had a real physical effect on his body, and he was shaking, and he was crying, and he. So then, me and my friends, we went to a local pub, and we were speaking to the man who worked behind the bar, of the pub, and he was telling me that he had made the crop circle. Him and his friends had gone out a few nights before and made this crop circle. So there was no energy there. It was this man's belief. It was this man's belief that had created the experience. Belief and experience always go together. Knowledge and experience. You only ever experience what you know. And so another example, last month I was in another pub. I don't often go to pubs, actually, but for some reason these stories take place in pubs. And I was sitting there talking to a friend, and this man came in, and he had come to meet us and have a drink with us. And he told us that he could feel, as he was walking into the pub, he could feel just this presence, this wide open, beautiful, open, spacious presence. And I thought that was really interesting, because what was interesting is he said that he doesn't feel that anywhere else. He only feels that when he's going when he knows he's kind of going into like a spiritual place, you know, a place where there's someone there who he resonates with. And he starts to feel this kind of this energy. And what I said to him is that you can't experience that if you don't know it. Because what he was doing, you see, he was separating, he was making, you know, sitting with spiritual people more, somehow more important than ordinary life. He was kind of separating going to see Jeff Foster. He was separating that from ordinary life. So,
I'm not doing that. Since I've been back from India, I'm enjoying the ordinary more. So it's I'm not looking for these big experiences. All I'm saying is there, the experience is so much deeper. And it's not because I'm going there like some, it's hard to explain. I can't put it in words.
No, you can't. But the invitation is that that can be seen here. I'm talking about here, you know? That's the invitation.
So you don't think there's anything people can do to strengthen their experience of the magnificent ordinary?
This is the point, you know. This is the point, the bit that's impossible to put into words. This isn't a special experience that I'm having. It's almost the falling away of that search for any sort of special experience. And again, this isn't to deny these experiences can be wonderful and peaceful and beautiful.
I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about what you were talking about earlier about how wonderful the ordinariness is. You know. So, as comparing that to when you were trying to live out in the nothingness, you know? Yeah. I don't know. Maybe the words. I'm hearing the words.
Well, it's not. Look, it's not about a doing. You see, it's not about a doing. This is the thing, and this is why it's so difficult to talk about. And again, it's interesting that the mind. It's like the mind wants something to do, and that's in a way what was noticed is this was always looking for something to do. What can I do? What can I do? What can I do? What can I do? And what was always being missed is that this is already being done in a sense. This is already appearing. This is all like breathing. Is already happening. So let's get right back to basics. Let's get right back to basics. So right now, okay. So right now, sounds are happening, right? The sound of this voice, the sound of cars going in the background. I don't know. It's sounds happening, and they just appear, you know, effortlessly. Effortlessly, sounds just happen, and they're heard. They appear without you having to do anything. There's no doing involved in that. In that present appearance, there's no doing. So what happens then is that the mind comes in, thought comes in, or you could say the person, the ego, or whatever you want to call it, and tells the story. I'm hearing. I'm doing. I'm hearing sounds. I'm separate from sounds. And in the same way, right now, presently, breathing. You know, breathing is happening, you know, effortlessly, in and out, effortlessly. Without you having to do anything. And it's like even. You know, even in deep dreamless sleep at night, you know, even in deep dreamless sleep when you're not even there to know it, breathing happens. You know, the heart beats. Right now, breathing is happening, heart beating effortlessly. And again, you know, thought comes in and goes, I'm breathing, my heart beating, I'm seeing, I'm hearing, I'm thinking. So the what I'm suggesting is that's the illusion, right? There's no one there hearing, seeing, thinking. That all comes later. That's all the stuff that's added on to what's happening. That's the thought story. That's the story of me doing. Well, what I'm saying is that this present appearance of everything, literally just this, the simplicity of this, the ordinariness of this, of sounds happening, maybe feelings in the body, this includes the body, you know, feelings in the body happening, arising. And you could say they just happen, like out of nowhere. They just happen. Sounds happen. Thoughts appear. It's something out of nothing. It's nothing appearing as something. It's oneness. I mean, there's so many ways of saying oneness appearing as everything. And I'm not suggesting that you take this on as a new philosophy or a new religion or a new belief system. This is about a seeing, you know. It's a seeing this, and seeing that in this present expression of life, in present sounds happening and thoughts, this present expression of everything, this is already complete. This is a complete expression of life. So when I say things like, there's no practice that can get you here, this is what I'm really pointing to, is that this is beyond practice or no practice. This presence, this openness, whatever you want to call it, just everything happening. Nothing else is needed. You don't need to add anything to this. This is already complete. And like in that, the mind comes in, the person comes in and goes, this isn't enough. This isn't enough. On some level, this isn't enough. And that's the separation. It's the same thing, you know, every single morning. It's like in deep dreamless sleep, there's absolutely nothing. And there's no one there to even know nothing. There's just the vastness of being, whatever you want to call it. And then in the morning, what appears to happen is out of that vastness, out of the vastness of being, there appears to be this contraction back down into a separate me, a separate person, an I. And the moment you have this I, the moment you have a me, you have a world of time and space. And it's like the individual is born. And on some level, that individual feels not quite at home, like not quite at home here, not quite. So on somehow separate from this, and somehow there's a sense of lack, a sense of not quite being whole, but there's a sense that there's something missing here, there's something missing in this present appearance, that somehow this isn't enough. So it's out of that sense of lack that the individual begins to seek, and they go out into the world of time and space and practices. And again, there's nothing wrong with that. I'm not suggesting there's anything wrong with that at all. Never would I say that. What I'm suggesting is something beyond practice. And this isn't a rejection of practice. I want to be very clear about that, because of course that would just be another religion, wouldn't it? That would be the no practice religion. That would be the practice of no practice. So what I'm suggesting is that there's something here that it's already whole. It's already complete, and it's what you are. And that can be recognized. You know, that can be noticed. It can be noticed in the midst of ordinary life, like here and now, ordinary life. You know, within the story, you know, you can still go off to Pune and or, you know, but it's like, what about here and now? What about seeing this? And the other thing
really,
I want to be
clear
about.
You know, when you said and that can be noticed, you know, like that's the testimony we've come here to listen to. You know, you're telling us, and that can be noticed. You know, and that is like, God, thank you. You know, that's really what we wanted to know. All over the world or what?
I mean, of course it can be. Otherwise, why we wouldn't even be talking about it, right? Would we? I mean, if something couldn't be noticed here, you know, of course something can be noticed, something can be seen, something can shift. Of course, well, it wouldn't even bother talking about it, you know. But the point is, when I say, you know, when I lift up the mug and say this is extraordinary, this is amazing, I'm not saying that and again, this is the bit that's impossible to communicate. I'm not saying that that Jeff is having an experience of that. I'm not saying that Jeff experiences this as being amazing and out of this world. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that beyond the concepts of extraordinary and ordinary, when we get just going beyond those concepts, beyond the story that this is extraordinary or this is ordinary, what is this? You know, what is this? And it's not an intellectual question. I mean, that's the thing. What is this? We could come up with a million intellectual theories. We could explain it in a million different ways, and we've kind of missed the point. You know, it's like the. Well, I'll say it. Just the gift, you know, the gift of what is, and that, and again, you see, this isn't a destination that I reached. Again, this is the impossible. This is why it's impossible to communicate. This isn't a place that I reach. It's not an experience that I'm having. What apparently fell away was the desire for any particular experience or any special experience beyond this experience. Beyond what's happening, breathing happening and thoughts happening. Just very, it's very ordinary. This isn't a special state. It's not a special state that I'm in and you're not, or that it's not about awakened people, enlightened people. That's all in the dream. That's all in the dream. This is most ordinary. It's natural present being, you know. So, and I can understand when people come to my meetings and they get frustrated. It's like, Jeff, this is all wonderful, but what can I do? Because it's like the mind apparently wants something to do. What can I do? Because in that doing, it keeps itself alive, you know. It's like it wants a result. What can I do to get from where I am to where you are? So that's the illusion, and that's the same question that I would have asked years ago. That was my question. What can I do to get from here to there?
My question is more like not asked. Is, I guess my question was saying, from where you are, is there anything
this is the thing.
You can do that would give you more depth? And are you saying that depth is not important? Is that a better way to word it?
This is total depth. This is absolute depth.
Okay. So you're experiencing very deep. And
but it's again, it's another concept, shallow and deep.
Well, of course I'm limited by words as well, my friend. So.
But the point is that there's no one here separate from everything. So what you're talking about is a person having a deep experience.
What I'm talking about is that thing that's not separate, being able to experience things directly without the filters. And is there anything that people can do to remove those filters?
Yeah, they can listen to what I'm saying.
Okay.
It's not about doing. And again, you know, I don't blame people when they listen to this message and they walk away. I don't blame them. I don't blame them because this is what I'm talking about is just this here and now. Here and now.
I get
that's
that,
what
my
I'm
friend.
Talking about. I'm talking about that.
I get that, my friend. So that I think in my wording doesn't, I think I'm not putting things into words very well. Sorry.
No, I know what you're saying. I do. I know what you're saying. And
yeah,
it's like what's missing here? Who cares? Like, let's forget the future. Let's forget this future when you're going to have, or someone's going to have a deeper experience. What about this? If we're going to talk in terms of experience, what about this experience? So yeah. seen in clarity, that there's an infinite depth to this. If it's a depth, you could say it's an infinite depth, because it's that which encompasses everything. It includes everything, every thought, every feeling, every sensation, everything. It includes everything. In that sense, it's infinitely deep. But it's not an experience that I'm having, because there's no one here separate from everything. It's not an... I am what you are. You are what I am. This is already complete. And if a person wants a practice, there's a million teachers out there.
I have this. This brings up a whole other question. I'm sorry. I have this theory that someone, if it has the ability to go from that wide thing you're talking about, to very focused through the whole range, is quite more advanced than someone who can just go, "Wow, I'm everything here and now. This is the whole complete experience." But then you put them in their job, and they don't have the flexibility to go back into the world. Yeah. You know, so. Gets into a whole other 10-hour discussion.
I agree with you. You know, it's one thing talking about I'm everything or I'm oneness, everything's oneness. And it's like, yeah, so try saying that when you're in a concentration camp, say, you know.
Exactly. Like life is forcing the focus in really narrow, you know?
What I'm suggesting is that there's something here that is untouched by circumstance, by outer circumstances, you know? Well, even say that you're in that concentration camp. All your fancy concepts and ideas and beliefs about oneness, non-duality, okay, what do they mean in the face of what's happening? So that's why I always come back to it like this, here and now, because this cannot leave you. This is this. What's happening cannot leave you, because what's happening is always what's happening. Everything else will come and go. Even your experience, any experience that you have will come and go. Any wonderful, deep experience will come and go, you see.
That's a good example. Like what I was trying to say is, if you were in the concentration camp, how could practice, or is there anything that you could do so that you are experiencing that experience 100%? And weren't trying to use this as an escape, which happens to the satsang people a lot. They start trying to escape into the nothingness, you know?
Absolutely. I mean, that's why I always talk about this can so easily become a trap. This can so easily, and I understand that, you know, and that's why I always try to come back to life as it is. Beyond our stories about it, beyond even our stories about ourselves and our spiritual development, you know, and our achievements, and our levels of enlightenment and our levels of awakening. It's like life is very, very, very simple. Simple. There's just what's happening. And that's true here, and that's true in a concentration camp. There's just what's happening. And so you're absolutely right. Look, if this doesn't include everything, this has to include everything. Maybe that's what you meant by the word depth. I don't know. This has to include everything. And you're right. If it doesn't, then it's a philosophy. If it doesn't, then it's a concept. If it doesn't, then it's a religion. But the point is, you only ever have to deal with what's happening now. Like, you know, that's all there is. There's just this present appearance of everything, and it's full and it's complete.
So there's nothing people can do to make sure or to help them include everything. There's nothing to do with that.
that's why I always have to answer on two levels. Of course, within the world of time and space, there's a million different things they can do. And I gave you one before. Notice this. Notice present sight. If you want a practice, that's a wonderful practice. At the same time,
in a way, it's that's like really saying, okay, notice this is a practice, as opposed to another practice saying, what could I do? You know, because I know I had a better experience somewhere else. What can I do is always about tomorrow. It's just got to be an idea that says tomorrow could be better, you know. And then
it involves time.
The practice is notice this. Notice this is not about any tomorrow. It's just notice. It's awareness.
So it's like what you long for the most, what you long for more than anything, is your own absence. And yet there's nothing that you can do to reach your own absence, because there would be someone there doing, right?
That reinforces your presence, huh?
Well, exactly, exactly.
When I was in Pune, I was disappearing so much that for the first time in years, I actually felt my mind like completely freaking out, like trying to scramble in. It was getting so destroyed, you know, like I was becoming so absent there, and I felt myself actually trying to scramble back into place. You know, it was really a weird experience.
What I'm saying is that this can be discovered here. This absence is always available. It's always, because ultimately you were never there. There was never anyone there. There was only the appearance of someone who was there. So, so it's like the individual hears about something called awakening or even their own absence, and all the individual can do is try to look for that. The individual starts to look for that. And the only place they have in which to look is their own world, which is their own reflection, you see. The individual and the individual's world, they're reflections of each other. So the point is, anything that you find within your world, which is the world of time and space, anything that you find within your world is going to be a reflection of yourself. So the individual hears about something called, you know, liberation or your own absence, their own absence, and starts to look for that within their world, within the world of time. They start to use time and space, and they look all over the world, all the different teachers and practices and methods, and all they will ever find is their own reflection. All you'll ever find within the world of time and space is your own reflection, whereas what you long for more than anything is your own absence, is the absence of your world, the absence of the world of time and space. So this is why it's impossible to communicate in language anyway, this, because language always operates within the world. It's always worldly language. It's always language of time and space. It's always language of the individual. What we're really trying to point to, what I'm really trying to convey, is not something that you could find within your world. What I'm pointing to is the falling away of your world, the falling away of the individual and its reflection, which is the world. Now, the moment we even talk about that falling away of the individual, we're using language. We're using language of the individual. We're back into the world of time and space. That's why these could only ever be pointers.
But that experience is so full on to our nervous system that we can't hold that experience very long, that falling away experience. The world's going to return in its form and everything pretty quickly. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and I think what people sometimes mean when they talk about a falling away experience, what they're really saying is that it was a rejection of the world. Because this, well, I'm not talking about an experience, you see. An experience is always in time. An experience needs an experiencer. It needs someone there to claim it as an experience.
Okay. Should I get off here? I've used up like 36 minutes of your guys' talk. Is there anything else waiting?
There's no time, though. It doesn't matter.
Okay. But,
I think that's good. You know, that's a good idea, Glenn, because, you know, I want to see if I can get one more caller in there. You really evoked a lot of subjects that I think are really helpful to everybody.
Yeah. And really great. Thank you.
So anyhow, a lot of love to Korea, and thanks for calling. And I totally know what you're talking about with Pune, because I was in the Oregon experiment there for years. And also, I just know the whole conundrum of the whole thing, so... Thanks a lot for being with us.
Yeah.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Wow. Wow, we pretty much covered everything now, haven't we?
Well, I don't know. We're going to see.
Life, death,
I was bound to come up with something else, you know. The world is vast.
Hi.
Hi.
Oh.
What's your name?
Hello.
Oh, Richard. I'm Rakshita from Mexico.
Hello, Rakshita.
Hello, Rakshita.
Yes. I'm still alive after the accident. And I would... Do you hear me?
Yeah, we can.
Yes.
Okay. And what fix it? Okay. I would like to talk about the aftermath of my accident. Just briefly for Jeff. Hi, Jeff. I had a difficult accident, and I had a waking up. I'm talking now about me, but it was a waking up from me as being part of it and seeing the accident as something that was just happening without blame and observation. I don't know, I could feel the body, the shock and everything. But it was a happening, you know, a happening, no opinion about it. So I just want to leave that and talking about now and afterwards, being back as a person in life. I was fine going back to having opinions, watching that. I mean, the driver left and there was somebody to blame, but also coming back to this happening. Do I explain that well? Just as a happening. And yesterday I got a telephone call and there was all of a sudden the mind talking. All what I would have thought before the accident. So there was mind talking about blame and not being right, and I should be better. I should have another influence onto the police because, you know, everybody has an opinion about the Mexican police. They are not good. So I was trusting the police, and all of a sudden, I had all the old mindset back. So it was not another mind, it was the mind.
The mind.
The old self-image I've had always about who I am and the others are, it was like a bomb. And I was reacting in the old way also. So, afterwards, after a time, I could see the whole play. And listening to you, it is as if this is also the same. There is not a real falling back to something. It's part of the whole. It's part of being present, what is happening. Before I was judging, it was something bad happening. That I fall back into being a person. But then I said, that's also part of the observation or witnessing or whatever.
It's astonishing. It includes everything. And that includes the appearance of the person, you know, I mean, and that's love. Love is, you know, I used to think that this was all about, you know, years ago, I used to think that this was all about getting rid of the person, getting rid of Jeff. And, you know, that was my goal, was to get rid of the person. And, you know, it was never about that. It was never about getting rid of the person. It was always about love. It was always about falling in love with the person. You know, it was never about getting rid of Jeff. And for so many years, Jeff was the enemy. It's like the mind was the enemy. I thought that the mind was something that I needed to get rid of. But, I mean, of course, who would get rid of the mind? It was the mind trying to get rid of mind. It was, you know, it was Jeff trying to get rid of Jeff. Just vicious circles. And it didn't work. It can't work. Because oneness is everything. It appears as everything. And it's like there's no mistakes. You know, this individual isn't a mistake. Because a lot of these teachings, you know, Advaita teachings, that there's no one here, there's no person, or that there's just an absence. There's only an absence. They're pointers. They can be very useful pointers, but also they can be really misleading, and they can cause a lot of confusion and a lot of suffering, actually. I mean, I've seen people really suffer because they believe that there's only an absence, or that they believe that there's no person. And it's like, that's a person, you know, that's a personal belief. It's like the person believing that there's no person. So the shocking thing was to discover, like, my God, this includes everything. This includes Jeff. And although ultimately, you know, you could say there's no one here, there's no Jeff, there's just what's happening, still within oneness arises the story of the individual, the story of Jeff. And the beauty of it is, you know, you get to keep that. It's like that gets to be there, that's allowed to be there, you know. That's part of this love too, is it's Jeff, you know, and although it's just a story, you know, it's like when someone comes to ask me, you know, my name, what's your name? I don't say there's no one here. I don't say there's only oneness. I don't say there's no person. What I find is that, you know, it says Jeff. It's a wonderful story. And, you know, in the same way, if someone asks you, you know, what did you do yesterday? You don't say there is no yesterday, you know. What are you going to do tomorrow? You don't say there is no tomorrow. You tell the story. You tell the story of yesterday, and you tell the story of tomorrow. And there's no problem with it. There's just no problem with it. And so everything is included in this. And that's the stunning realization. You know, that's the whole. It's like the whole thing comes full circle almost. It's like it begins with, you know, an ordinary person living an ordinary life. And then there might be a discovery that there's no one there. That underneath that ordinary life, there's no one there. There's just an absence. There's emptiness. And what might happen is the whole thing might come full circle. And it's like you come back to this world somehow. It's like you get to live as this, you know. And right here, there's the story of Jeff. And every morning, the eyes open, and this body appears to be here. You know, is it mine? Is it not mine? I don't know. I don't care. It's like you stop caring. You know, am I Jeff? Am I not Jeff? It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. The whole thing ends in just the paradox of it. Like that absence that we talk about, and it could be a very misleading word, because really there is no absence. That absence is a total, full, complete presence. It's the presence of everything, and the individual, the story of the individual is included. You know, this is all embracing love. This is unconditional love. Unconditional love.
Yes, and I really resonate. I cannot put it into words what you are saying, but absence.
I can't either.
It is something like one word that says yes to life.
Yeah.
To life and to everything, what happens everything. In life. And even when I fall, it's as I fall, it's a happening. There is Rakshita, she falls, but she stands up and she says, no, it's gone. So it's just yes. And I think this yes, that is love for me.
Yeah.
To say yes, this including everything, it's the same as oneness. It's not the oneness in bliss or whatever. It's feeling oneness with the policeman, you know? I can't tell that to anybody, but that's really what I felt. Oneness with, you know, when I blame the police, I'm just going into the same consciousness that everybody tells the Mexican police is bad and they don't work and corrupt. So when I put my ideas also in that consciousness, I'm part of it.
Yeah.
There is never a change. You understand what I mean? There's never a change. Everybody wants a change, but always falls into this same routine, into the same mindset. So I just say yes, and I'm innocent. There's another word for it.
Innocent.
I don't know that the police is bad, in my experience. So I'm innocent. And from that place of innocence, I am.
And then you come to see that it's not even you saying yes. It's like, this is already the yes. You know, this is already yes. This is already yes because it's happening.
It's too late to say yes.
It's too late to say yes. That's a great title.
Yes. It is too late because it already happened. I mean, I say yes or I say no. It really doesn't matter what I say.
It's
over.
Like the yes includes the no. This is a big giant yes that includes the yes and the no, you know? It's like the no could be a giant yes.
And the effect is the same, anyway.
Oh.
I mean the effect.
Yeah.
I mean, one is probably suffering, and the other one is just what it is.
And then, I mean, the real freedom is to see that even the suffering, even it's like, oh look, there's Jeff suffering, or there's someone suffering. That's all it is. It's just someone suffering in that moment. It has no more importance than that. It's just someone suffering. You know, there can be freedom in the midst of suffering. In the midst of suffering, the yes can be there. The yes can be there in the midst of suffering. Yeah, the yes can be there at the heart of suffering. I always think of Jesus on the cross. You know, right at the heart of the most intense suffering, right at the heart of that suffering was the yes.
Yeah. Yeah,
and that's beautiful, you know, that when it's like, then there's nothing to fear, then there's just nothing to fear, then all that's left is just to live this, you know, to live this, what's happening now. And you see that you're not even living it. It's just living itself. It's just living itself. And then, you know, then you just tell your stories. You tell the story of Jeff sitting on a chair, Jeff's talking. But you can't believe it anymore. It's like you just see it as a story, and then it's beautiful. And like a child, you get to play with stories. You see that this has always been a play. This has always been a play. We just took it. We used to take it so seriously because we thought we were separate from it. We thought we were separate from this, and so on some level, we saw the world as a threat. It's like the moment you have an individual who has something, the moment you have an individual who possesses something, then there's always the fear of losing what you have. And then, so on some level, the world and other people, they become a threat because they can take away what you have. But so when you see that really there's no one here who has anything, then there's nothing to lose. So then there's nothing to fear, because then there's no power in the world that can take anything away from you. And that's the real freedom. That's the freedom in the midst of life. You know, I'm not talking about freedom in the future. I'm not talking about practicing your way to freedom. I'm talking about like this, you know, this here and now, and it's free. It's completely free. This is what people don't understand.
So when there's nothing that anyone can take away from you, there's nothing that anyone can give to you. So there's nowhere to go. And even if the experience like is always changing, sometimes it's really rich. Like when we were talking about Pune, and sometimes it's you know, and it sucks us into saying, oh yeah, tomorrow could be a better day.
But you know what? And then it's just free to be what it is. It doesn't have to be anything in particular. And then it just has to be what it is, right? It has to be what it is. And then you just get to play with it. You get to see what happens next. You know, and then you have no way of knowing. And that's the for the individual, that's terrifying because that's the end of control. But of course, it's not really terrifying at all. That's the freedom. There's always been something here that longed to let go of control. It longed for that more than anything. It didn't really want awakening. It didn't really want enlightenment. It didn't really want to transcend the ego. What it longed for more than anything was to die. Was to fall in love. Anyway, same thing.
It happens right now. It happens. Being with me or without me and life, I cannot stop life right now. It's not to be stopped. It cannot be stopped.
You're condemned to live.
Without me. It's just running without me and without you. It's, you know what I'm talking about? It's I'm here or I'm not here. It doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter. That is, exactly. It doesn't.
With absence, right?
Yeah. It doesn't matter. You'll never know. The point is, you will never know if you're here or you're not here. That will always be a story. That will always be a story. Beyond the stories, this is just the mystery. It's just the mystery. I'm here, I'm not here. Self, no self. Choice, no choice. Absence, presence. Duality, non-duality. It doesn't matter. It just doesn't matter because life is already happening. And life, it's already expressing itself. It doesn't need you to understand it. That's the freedom, is seeing that there's nothing to understand. Nothing to understand.
Thanks so much, Rakshita.
Great,
thank you, Rakshita.
Great. Thank you, Richard.
Lots of love.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Goodbye.
Bye.
Just turn me off. I don't know how.
Oh, yeah, we know how. Bleep.
Why is Jeff speaking if there's nothing to understand?
Oh, yeah.
It's a very good question. Why not? That's where we live, you know. It's in the why not. We're just children, we're playing. Why not? You know, it's I always say that, you know, you can find a million different reasons why we should never speak about this, really. You could find a million reasons why we should just stay silent, and there could be a preference there for silence, but and of course, the moment you talk about this, you're using words, and words are always dualistic. And but once that's seen, then you're free. Well, once it's seen that you have no way of putting this into words, then you're just free to play with words and to attempt to point to something using words, because words aren't the enemy. And I don't see noise as any lower or higher than silence. I don't see silence as any lower or higher than noise, and because ultimately they're not separate. And that, and really the words, you know, it's as much in the words as outside of them. It's as much in the silence between the words as it is in the words. So he is talking to me. Wow. Yeah.
Let's see if somebody's on the phone.
Hello? What would Jeff say to himself as a seeker?
That's
a good question.
Yeah. Tell us about being on the phone. Who's on the phone?
Hello?
What's your name?
Yeah, my name is Frank. I'm calling from Florida.
Thanks, Frank.
Hey, Frank.
Hey, after I ask this, I'm going to hang up so I can actually hear better. It's easier for me to hear when I hang up because on the phone it's not coming through so clear.
We'll try it for a while because we got a new phone hookup.
Okay, well, anyway, as I said, I'm having a hard time hearing you, but I'm going to go anyway. I had a question for Jeff. I've been kind of following him for a couple of years.
Wow.
And when I came
I didn't know I had any followers.
It changed. Sorry, it's hard for me to hear you when you respond with what I got here. Anyway, bear with me. I was working with a guy who did sort of energetic type work. This all happened through an event in my life that kind of shook things up. And my reality got questioned really deeply. What is this about? What is going on? I had this at a young age, put it on the shelf, and anyway, I got a wake-up call. I started working with a guy, and he could take me only so far, I guess. But when I came across your book and I read some of I Am That, that changed the picture dramatically. It kind of shook up all the processes and all this pathway to getting to somewhere. And it's an energetic shift. And, you know, here we work towards it. And I churn up my past and I sift through it all. And sometimes when I watch some of the people on Never Not Here, I actually get irritated because I feel like there's a lot of teachers out there that are pointing people in a misleading direction. Mm. And that's my business. That frustrates me. But I like Jeff's message. It's very clear. And one person that you used to quote was, or in your book, is Yuji Krishnamurti.
Oh, yeah.
And he speaks from a place that I really identify with because I found an extreme amount of frustration and pain. I can only say it's pain because I don't know what it is. But it's as if my brain has been so scrambled at this point that I can't make sense of a lot of things. And my life has turned upside down, and I find people doing the searching, and I can see sometimes how people can get so lost in the bliss, the idea of what it is. Yep. But when you talk about it being a frightening thing to the individual, that is what my primary experience was, that I heard about the depression that you had, and and I've come to a point with the UG stuff, which it's like I see the futility, that there's nothing really that I can do to get there because I see how my attempts are just circles, spinning in circles, and my mind spins in circles, and it seems like I can't stop it. I don't think there's methods to get there because I've seen those run through. I worked with somebody else who had methods. So I feel like I'm just left with this no man's land of I'm not fully embedded in being into the story, but I'm not into this place where I don't think I'm a separate person. I believe I'm separate. That's you know, that's going on. And so it's like I just wait for one day when whatever this horror is that I feel goes away. But that's all I have right now is that. Yeah. And so in a sense, I watch this program. I listen to you. I guess it comforts me to some degree, but otherwise, day by day just passes by in sort of a no man's land, and I'm running out of options. I'm running out of places to go, and I see people with lots of places to go. Oh, go meditate. Oh, do this, do that. I don't know. You know? And so for me, it's a huge frustration, and I see a lot of people that don't seem to be so much in that frustrating place. And I'll stop, let you respond to this. But I'm going to hang up because I can't really hear or I'll have to mute my phone while you talk, I guess.
Thanks a lot, Frank.
Thanks, Frank.
Thank you. Appreciate it, Richard.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jeff.
So, yeah, I mean, it's no man's land. It's a great question. The spiritual search... hopefully, you know, eventually leads to exhaustion. Hopefully, eventually you become exhausted with the whole thing. You start to see through it and the futility of it. I was a very, very intense spiritual seeker and really intense. You know, I shut myself away for a year, 2 years, and that's all I did from morning to night, really, was just seek and seek and seek, read spiritual books and meditate and... And really, the whole thing ended in despair. I mean, it's funny because people, you know, because I write books and do talks or whatever, people think that I must have succeeded, right? Jeff must have succeeded because he did all the spiritual seeking and then he awakened. Well, I mean, that couldn't be further from the truth. I've never said anything of the sort, never. The seeking ultimately must end in failure because it's the mind looking for something it cannot have. It's the mind looking for something it cannot have. And so where I ended up years ago was just, it's very similar to Frank's story, just this place, Well, nothing really meant anything anymore. I completely saw through the futility of seeking, and yet I still felt separate. And I had these stories as well about this. I was still waiting for something to happen. I was still waiting for like the final events or the final falling away or the final shift or the energetic shift or whatever. It was like I'd kind of given up doing anything, because what I'd seen was that, you know, anything I do is going to fuel the sense of being a separate person. It's there's going to be a me there doing something to get free. At the same time, I by that point I couldn't give up, because to me it was either you know, I couldn't go back to the way it was. So really, I always say this. People laugh when I say I fail. My spiritual seeking failed. I failed to awaken. Jeff Foster failed to awaken. So it's like what Frank was saying, that recognition, kind of in living in this no man's land, you kind of can't go back to the world. You can't regress. You can't go back to the way it was, but at the same time, you can't seem to go forward either. You're kind of dangling in this place, kind of almost like half in the world, but half not in the world, and there's still this hope, you know, still this kind of subtle hope that at some point it's going to fall away, it's going to shift. And this was the place that I was in a few years ago. And of course, you know, at the time I thought, well, this is hopeless, you know, and I just thought, well, there's nothing I can do. There's nothing I can do. I can't make this shift happen. All these teachers they seem to have had this shift, and I couldn't seem to do it. I couldn't seem to get it. So I said, well, maybe it's just a question of luck. Maybe it's a question of grace. Maybe I should just sit here and wait for it to happen. Maybe I'll try doing nothing. I'll try sitting back doing nothing, because a lot of these teachers say do nothing or there's nothing you can do. So I'll try doing nothing. Or maybe I'll just try not to try. Maybe I'll just forget about it. So I try forgetting about it, you know. But all the time there was this kind of subtle hope. It was kind of like I call it the waiting game. It was like kind of, I was postponing living. You know, it was like life was happening, but I wasn't going to live. You know, I was kind of holding myself back from life because I thought there's something around the corner. There's this shift that's going to happen. There's something that's better than this. There's something that's better than this just around the corner. But the thing is, it never came, because, of course, there was still someone there waiting. There was still a separate me there waiting. So really, the whole thing ended in failure. Jeff failed. And so what Frank was saying is that there's a real intelligence to what he's saying, you know, in a sense that seeing the futility of the seeking, it's like there's already an intelligence there. There's already something there that knows there's something beyond seeking. You know, even to recognize the futility of seeking, there already must be an intelligence there that's, you could say, that's awakening, an intelligence there that's kind of waking up, recognizing that the futility of looking into a future for salvation. But of course the individual clings on to hope. It clings on to this vain hope, you know, and in that it keeps itself going. As long as you have hope, you can carry on being a person, right? As long as there's hope. But of course, as long as there's hope, there's also the threat of hopelessness. So, you know, you live with the constant threat of hopelessness. And it's and I recognize this. I mean, I understand it. And all I can say, it was in the midst of that despair. It was in the midst of that failure. It was in the midst of Jeff's failure that this was seen. That it was seen that, because really all I was left with, you could say, after years and years, actually after a lifetime of seeking, because we're all seekers, even if we're not spiritual seekers, after a lifetime of seeking, What did I have to show for it? Nothing. All my seeking hadn't led anywhere because I still found myself here. It's like, shit, I'm still here. And so it was in the midst of that absolute the failure of Jeff that this was seen. And you know, so people then say, well then it's okay for you, Jeff, because you searched, you know, it's like, Jeff, we have to seek before we fail. Well, the point is like, we've all failed enough. We've all failed enough, you know, and ultimately all seeking leads to failure because the mind is looking for something it can't have. So, and of course, this message is massively threatening to the seeker. This is the last thing the spiritual seeker wants to hear. The seeker who is so attached to their paths and their processes and their spiritual knowledge, they don't want to hear this. So I understand why people don't want to hear this. They're threatened by this message, or they think it's too simplistic, or they think it's, I don't know what they think. I can understand that because right here, right now, this is the death of the seeker, the absolute death of the seeker. So, and of course, the other trap here is that, you know, people then say, right, well, I need to fail. Jeff failed, and then he awakened. I didn't say that either. I never said that. What was seen is that there's no one here who could awaken, because there was never anyone here separate from everything. In other words, this had always been complete. I had always been complete. There was a wholeness here that really had nothing to do with Jeff and his seeking, or Jeff and his achievements or lack of achievements, and Jeff and his knowledge or his ignorance. What was seen in the midst of all that was life as it is. And that isn't a special state. That can be seen now. That can be seen now. I'm not awakened. There's no such thing. There's no such thing as personal awakening. Yeah. Someone who thinks they're awakened is just a person with a story about awakening. Someone who thinks they're enlightened is just someone with a belief that they're enlightened and they're separate from people who aren't enlightened. So, there's a real intelligence, you could say, to that failure, to that sense of futility. But the point is, it doesn't end there. It doesn't end there. That futility, that sense of failure, is always pointing to something beyond itself, you know. And the whole thing, it's like, it's almost like you're stripped of everything. Everything you've tried has failed. You're stripped of everything. In a way, you're left with nothing. That's what the mind says anyway. The mind says, well, I tried everything. Now I'm left with nothing. Nothing worked. I'm left with nothing. And of course, that's the secret, is that nothing is everything. That there never was nothing. It's almost like the mind says, I'm everything, I do everything, I choose everything, I make everything happen. I'm a person, I'm thinking, I'm seeing, I'm hearing, I'm doing everything, I'm in control of my life, I'm a person in control of life. The person thinks I'm everything. So it's like the person projects, the mind projects, in the absence of me, in the absence of me and mine, me and my control. In the absence of me, there'll be nothing. That's the projection it makes. I'm everything. In the absence of me, there'll be nothing. Actually, that nothing is everything. There never was anyone here in control. There never was a seeker here. There never was anyone here doing the seeking. That was always the illusion. So actually, nothing is lost. All that could possibly be lost is the illusion of control. There was never anyone here in control. So that's the mind finds this message threatening, because it sees it as a threat to what it has, my control. Basically, it all comes down to control. The whole damn thing comes down to control, trying to control life, trying to get what I want. That's really what it's all about. That's really what it's all about. Getting what I want. the shocking thing about this is that this was never anything to do with you. This was never anything to do with you and what you wanted. It was never to do with you. And that's shocking to the, it's the last thing the spiritual seeker wants to hear, you know, that essentially life doesn't need you. You know, life, it's, doesn't need you. Doesn't need you and your seeking and your suffering and your misery. It doesn't need you. It doesn't reject you. It would never stop you from doing. It would never stop you from seeking. Doesn't need it. Perfectly complete without it. And that completion, the shocking thing is that that completion was always here. We just couldn't see it. The completion was sitting on a chair breathing. Sitting on a chair breathing. The heart beating. Drinking, having a drink of water. You know, it was always, it was never about you. It was never about the seeker. It was always about life. It was always about this.
Hello?
And this is already complete.
Let's see who's on the phone. Do you hear us on the phone? Hello?
Yes, it's Willie.
Hey, Willie! Yeah.
Hello? Willie!
Hi, Richard.
Willie from Florida.
Actually, I'm in northeast Alabama, up in the mountains.
Hey! It's great to hear you again. John, great to hear your voice.
And John just called me and told me that Jeff's on the webcast, so I'm watching Jeff, and I just thought I'd send my love to both of you.
Aw, thanks, Willie. Lots and lots of love. Lots of love back to you. Lots of love from yourself back to yourself.
And Jeff, I was just at a spiritual gathering where the topic was for 4 hours was laughter, and I thought of you. I told the group about how the people who I admire the most, they laugh the most, and you and Maharishi came to my mind, and I told them that.
I'm always suspicious of people who take themselves too seriously. I really am. This is a play, you know. I mean, what's left but to laugh? You know, life it's just light. Life is just light, and I don't know. It's the cosmic.
You know, John, one time John McGuire and I were on the beach and in Florida. Someday I'd love for you and John and I to be on the beach in Florida. And he said, Willie, looking out into the ocean, he said, what's not to like? And that's, again, something that you've reminded me in meeting you and Maharishi and a number of, you know, the people who I admire greatly. They just look at life and say, what's not to like?
What's not to like?
Is that not so?
Yeah, it's seen for what it is. It's such a gift, you know, and it's like we're given this for free. It's just free. It's absolutely free, you know. And our misery as human beings is that we want so much more than what we have, than what we've been given for free. We demand more. We want something in the future. We want money. We want an awakening. We want to awaken. We want to be enlightened. It's like, what's wrong with this? And when you see this, the gift of this, you're not even interested in that anymore. You know, you're not even interested in all of that. And it was all a dream anyway. It was all a dream. This, if there is any awakening, it's this. If there is any enlightenment, it's this. The word enlightenment, you know, literally to enlighten, to light up. You know, this is already enlightened. It's already lit up. Look, it's lit up. It's revealing itself. It's showing itself. It's offering itself. And just the gratitude, you know, of that. When that's seen, when it's seen, this, like this is all you get. This is all you get. And that's terrible for a seeker. That's the worst thing in the world for a seeker. You know, but when that's really seen in clarity, that's the most liberating thing of all, that this is all you get. So then you can live this. Finally, you get to live this. And you get to play with this. Yes, and... But yeah, I'd love to come to the beach.
There's a lot of tenderness inside of me right now, and I know that it's from having spent a lot of time with the few people that were at this little gathering today up in the mountains, just really recognizing that for me, I can hear clearly, and I'm grateful that I can hear clearly what you're talking about inside of me, and it's just, for me, it's a matter of just continuing to listen to that, which is the ocean, which is the tenderness of a wholeness that I sit there and I'm talking with these people and I talk about kind of witnessing the whole thing, and I start laughing and they start laughing, and there's all there is just that laughter and the tenderness. Awesome. And then I get home to where I'm staying now, and John McGuire called me up and says, "Hey, Jeff Foster's on a live webcast, and how much more tender and blissful can it be to be connecting with you, Jeff? It's wonderful."
Oh, thanks, Willie. It's lovely to hear from you, and I hope to see you real soon.
When you said that, I just can hear that. You know, you said I can hear it, and that's actually how we started the show, because Jeff was saying this can be noticed. You know, this can be noticed. And yeah, as a thought, it's boring. But as a notice, it's everything.
Yeah, that's the thing. As a thought, what we're talking about is boring as hell. I mean, really, if you're just listening to the words that we've been saying, you'll probably be asleep. You probably would have fallen asleep, you know, hours ago. I mean, this is boring stuff we're talking about, you know. But that's why I always say it's not about the words. The words are just pointers. And they're pointing to this. Something that's very alive. It's very alive. It's very tender, and it's very real, and it's love. I mean, there's so many words for the wordless. You know, it's love, and really, we're just here to remind ourselves. I mean, these are your words. You know, you tune into Never Not Here to remind yourself of what you know. And of course, it's like, and that's what the resonance is that people talk about. The resonance is, because you're not resonating with someone else. The resonance is, yeah, this is me. I know this. I've always known this because this is my dream. It's like within your dream, you know, within your dream, you know, Jeff Foster appears maybe. And really it's just yourself dressed up as Jeff Foster appearing in your own dream to remind yourself of what you already know, and that's the resonance, because it's your dream. So the illusion is that someone is talking to someone else. The illusion is that I'm talking to you, or it's that never happened. That never happened. There's only this love, and that's more real than anything. I mean, it sounds like some far out philosophy. I understand why people listen to this and they think it's mumbo jumbo and they think it's just, I don't know, a new belief system, and that's fine. You know, people will think what they think. Really, this is real. This is life. It's life.
You know, it's interesting. There's this woman. Hello?
Yeah, we hear you, Willie.
Hello.
Yeah, there was this, can you hear me?
Yeah, we hear you.
Yeah.
Okay. There was this woman who's the director of some big organization in Alabama on a state level, and she's been entrusted with a huge grant of money, $400,000, to help deal with racism in Alabama, a state, if you don't know this, Jeff, a state that's traditionally or historically rife with racism. And she asked me at this little gathering today, what would I do to deal with the issue, or how could I, what did I have any solutions or ideas for her about racism? And when she asked me, I was feeling this just bliss. I felt just this ocean of bliss inside. and tenderness, and no thoughts came to me. And I just said to her, well, you know, because she said, because we're trying to not be judgmental. And I said to her, you know, it's like Yoda in Star Wars said, no trying, just doing. But I realized it was an awakening inside of me. It said, when I'm in that state of wholeness, or that state of tenderness inside, there's no thought of racism. I mean, there's no question. It doesn't even come up. I am talking to a wave on the ocean. I'm a wave talking to a wave. There is no separation of whether it's, oh, that person's black or fat or skinny or rich or poor. It's just sharing. It's just, you know, and I've heard you say before, this is just a sharing. I'm not a teacher. I just want to share. And I said that to this woman, and she nodded her head, and with all of her heart, I could see she wanted to take that in, but her mind, she said, but is there anything that we can do about that? And I said, yeah, you can just role model it. You can just be that. And that's the best I could do. I don't know that a political answer or I don't know that there's answers on the activity level that do that.
Krishnamurti, he said, there is no how to be free. If you ask how to be free, you're not listening.
Yeah, well said. I miss you, and I love you.
Love you too. I have to say hello to Jack, my friend Jack. He came to my retreat in Greece. He's so sweet. He's a little kid, and he's not a little kid. He's a young man, lovely young man, and he's a real sweetie. And I just say hello, Jack. Hello, Jack. Jack gets this. Believe me. Listen to Jack. Jack is the teacher. Jack says, the easiest way of what Jeff is explaining is that non-duality is everything and yet nothing, because nothing is everything. I mean, it's just amazing. Jack, how old are you? I forgot.
Is he in the chat?
Stop it, man. He's in the chat room.
Oh.
How old are you, Jack? I forgot. 12, you see. From the mouths of babes. The easiest way of what Jeff is explaining is that non-duality is everything and yet nothing, because nothing is everything. Isn't that beautiful? Oh, he's 12. He's 12. Hey, Jack, fantastic. I'm 58 and I still haven't got that.
Hello.
Hello, Alexander.
Yes, hello, hello. You're not going.
Oh.
Maybe dropped off. Alexander's, I don't know.
Disappeared into the universe.
Yeah.
Can you not hear me?
No. Yeah, I was off for a second. Try again. Repeat that.
Okay. I said that I had an amazing widening of perspective in the past hour when you were talking to a couple of people here. And I could start feeling that infiniteness, this infinite being from where life is manifesting, emanating, and sort of like choosing to present us with whatever happened. And the interesting thing in that was that I could have the perspective of the infinite looking inside into life happening, including myself in there, alternating with me as a self, realizing that I had that perspective and then having a story about it. And further, I could also notice that there is this capacity in that me self mind that can really zoom back in to that self importance and lose that wider perspective and being caught or identifying life and so forth. And the question that came up was, what is this that bring about the shift in perspective, zooming in and zooming out, you know, getting widened or getting contracted into something? Isn't it has to do with attention? You know, if I go back to your illustration of the balloon,
yeah,
it looks like it's a balloon within a balloon within a balloon, and who knows how many. But there's even the most inner balloon, there is air. And if air is attention, it's the same air that you have outside of all the balloons, which is also attention. So it's kind of interesting. I'd like to hear your perspective on that.
So, there is a balloon and there is no balloon. It really depends on what perspective you're coming from. So it's interesting. I think you talked about alternating. I might have heard, I'm not sure if I heard you correctly, alternating between this kind of vast open awareness and the person coming in.
Yes,
is that right? Is that what you were talking about, alternating? So actually, there is no alternation. Alternating implies that one is separate from the other, and it implies time. Actually, and again, this is why you can't go there with words. They are not two. That open, vast, open presence is not separate from the appearance of the individual. Like, absence is presence. The absence of you is identical with the appearance of the individual. But and this is something, thought will never capture it, because all thought can do is separate. Thought separates that openness, the attention, whatever you want to call it, the openness. Thought separates that from the individual. It's like the moment you say it, it sounds like there is an individual separate from. And then you start to talk about, you know, alternating between. Actually, there's no one here, and there's someone here at the same time. They're not separate. In other words, it's an absolute paradox. To the mind, it's an absolute paradox. This is no one appearing as someone. It's not no one fluctuating with someone. Sorry, it's not no one alternating with someone. That's how it might appear. But actually, it's no one appearing as someone. The no one is the someone. And that's the point where words, you cannot go any further with words. In other words, this cannot be understood. This cannot be understood. It's just the absolute not knowing. So what can appear is, it can appear as though that it alternates between, it's like it alternates between my absence and my presence. And this is, a lot of people talk about this, and this is the experience I had years ago. It's like there were times, moments, sometimes hours, sometimes days, when it's like Jeff wasn't there. Or at least that was my story at the time. And then there were times when it appeared that Jeff would come back in. And of course, back then there was a preference. There was a secret, hidden preference for Jeff's absence. That was Jeff's hidden preference, was Jeff's absence. So it's like, Jeff would appear, and it'd be like, on some level, it'd be like, oh shit, there's Jeff again. I preferred it when Jeff wasn't there. But of course, it was just the mind saying that. It was Jeff saying that, and it was Jeff saying that he wasn't there. Actually, So then people think, well then Jeff, what happened to you? What happened? People think that what happened is the periods of Jeff's absence got longer and the periods of Jeff's presence got shorter. Until finally, there was only absence of Jeff and there was no presence of Jeff at all. That's not true. Because, of course, you know, the only way that you could know that you were 100% absent is if there was a person there claiming their own absence. And this is, again, this is like the non-duality trap. There's plenty of people and sometimes teachers out there, and they're very proud of the fact that they're not there, that they're 100% absent. You know, and of course, the person who believes they're absent is just a person with a picture. They're living with a picture of themselves not being there. It's like a very personal image they have of themselves not being there. And then they say things like, I'm absent, but like, I'm not here, but you're still there, and things like that. And it gets very silly. So that the whole thing ends in the paradox that absence is not separate from the presence. The absence of you is identical with your presence. The absence of Jeff is the presence of Jeff. And that's, words cannot even touch it. It's just the mystery of it. And the beauty of it is, it doesn't need to be understood. I don't understand this. Anyone who claims to understand this is a liar. Sorry, that's not fair. Anyone who claims to understand this is a person with some concepts about this. So I'm always suspicious of people who claim to understand non-duality, who claim to know what they're talking about. You know, this is But yeah, your absence is your presence. You know.
Yeah, Jeff, and I. What would you say about the? The practice or idea of thanking and loving whatever shows up in your presence as an intention.
So what was the question again?
Okay, what would you say about the intention to thank and love intentionally whatever shows up in your presence?
I mean, I think that's a beautiful intention. But I guess what can be seen is that everything that arising is already love. Like, there is only love. Everything that arises is an expression of love, an expression of unconditional love. So this is unconditional love appearing as a world. This is unconditional love appearing as everything, appearing as every thought, every feeling, every sensation, appearing as a table and a chair and a microphone and eyes. This is unconditional love revealing itself as everything. So I'll give an example. You know when you fall in love, you know, maybe when you were a child and there was like a girl or a boy that you really fancied, you really loved them, and then one day they looked at you and they smiled and maybe they told you that they loved you or something, or they gave you a present, and your heart just exploded. It just exploded. And for the rest of the day, you know, you kind of walked, maybe you walked home from school or something, or you were walking home and just, you were walking down the street and just, you know, everything was just magnificent. Everything was extraordinary. You know, that, like the street itself, the cars and the people, the trees, that they hadn't really changed. It's just suddenly they were seen for what they were. It was just, they were just miraculous. The cars and the trees and the people and it's like there's something here that is already, this is what I'm talking about, already. There's something here that is already in love with everything. So like walking home down that street, see, you think you're in love with a person. Actually, you're in love with everything. You think that you fall in love with something. You think you fall in love with a person. actually all you're ever doing is falling in love with everything. You're falling in love with the cars and the trees and all the people and thoughts and feelings. You're falling in love with everything. Of course, then what happens is the mind comes in and tries to pin that love, because love is very threatening. Love is deadly, you know. So you try and make that love manageable somehow, and you try and pin that love down on one person. And then it becomes a game of possession, of trying to possess that person. Or it can be a spiritual teacher. The same thing can happen with a spiritual teacher or a guru. You know, you think you're falling in love with a guru. Actually, you're falling in love with everything. But you kid yourself. You think it's about a person. It was never about a person. So what I'm suggesting is that there's something here that is already in love with everything. That isn't something new. It's something that's always been there. And it's like that can be discovered. And that's really what we're talking about, is the discovery of that love that really isn't, it's not personal. It's not about you. It's not even about you and your intentions. I mean, intentions can be a beautiful thing, but the problem with intentions is the moment you intend something, you can always fail. You can always fail in your intentions. So this is a love that goes beyond even you and your intentions. It's the love that this is. This is love, and you don't need to actually do anything to get this. This is already what you are. You know, you're not separate from this, and that's really what the word love really points to, is, you know, the end of separation. And intimacy. This is like intimacy. When that separation is seen through, all that's left is just an intimacy with whatever's happening, and you know. Not just, it's like falling in love, but not just with a person or with a religious leader or something, but falling in love with the chair that you're sitting on, you know, falling in love with your hands and a mug of water.
And, maybe instead of saying intention, you could just say honor, you know, to honor. Basically honor, what does that mean? It just means to notice, you know, like to honor whatever's coming in front of you, instead of saying having any attention. To love it, just say honor that it has its own love with it, you know.
Exactly. It doesn't this love is so all encompassing, it's so fierce, it doesn't even ask you to love it. It doesn't even ask you to love it. It offers itself anyway. That's stunning. I mean it doesn't even ask you to notice it. It doesn't even ask you to see it. It just offers itself anyway. So the love, that's unconditional love. It's nothing to do with you, you see. It was always to do with life. It was never anything to do with you. Unconditional love was never something that you could find. It was always in the looking for it that we apparently lost it. This is unconditional love appearing as a world. It dresses up as a world. It dresses up as chairs and tables and thoughts and feelings and everything. But so that... there can just be a noticing of that. There can be a seeing, a discovery of that in everything, you know, in everything. It doesn't actually, it's like, you know, it's like the chair that you're sitting on doesn't actually ask you to love it.
Well,
it doesn't ask you to, it doesn't ask you to have an intention. It just offers itself anyway. That's unconditional love. The unconditional love is already appearing as a chair, which is already supporting you. So this is about like the discovery of what is already, and I think that's a really important word, of what is already the case.
Well, to clarify, the idea here was to train the mind to be grateful and loving as a habit, with the intention to resonate with the truth that you've been speaking of, which is already there. But when in moments or for people that in long time, like myself, you know, being caught in the self and in the mind. So when you realize you're caught in the mind, you know, why not notice what you've been caught in and thank it and love it as a practice.
Why not?
Okay.
Why not? This is the thing. This is why hey, sweetie, my girlfriend's here. This is why I don't give out practices, because you already have the practice you need. You already know this. everyone knows this already. It's just, it's like...
I hear you.
Thank you, Alexander. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Alexander.
Thank you.
That was wonderful. Lots of love.
Yeah.
And I just want to reply to something in the chat room.
Go for it.
Saggy Buns. Hello, Saggy Buns. That's a great name. Jeff, so the expansion into boundlessness or energetic shift that you hear teachers talk about is just a bunch of bullshit. Well, yes. Yes, it is. Yeah. It just becomes another, like, a golden carrot, you know? Energetic shift. I mean, nah. Just more stories. Yeah, it's bullshit. I mean, okay, everything's bullshit for a start. Everything is bullshit. Everything I say is bullshit. So, you know, this energetic shift or expansion into boundlessness, whatever. It's bullshit. It's not about blaming the teachers who talk about this, because of course it's we believed them. That's the point. We believed that there was this shift that was going to happen, and there was this shift that's happened to some people but hasn't happened to others. Of course, that's just massive separation. The point is we believe them. We believe them. So you can't really... This isn't to blame any teacher, and no one really misleads us. We only ever mislead ourselves. We buy into their stories. You know, the teacher who says to us, I'm enlightened, you're not enlightened, here's how to get enlightened, it's going to take 30 years, follow me. You can't really say they're misleading you. They really believe that. They really believe what they're telling you. I don't think many teachers are out there to mislead you intentionally. I think they really believe what they're talking about. But the point is we believe them. Like we buy into their stories, and we believe in the energetic shift or whatever, or the falling away of the eye.
We've been waiting for their story. We've been praying for their story to come to us.
Yeah.
And it's come, you know, finally someone's told us what we know is going to got to be true, you know, and then now we got the hook to get it, you know, because otherwise those stories, they don't even interest us, and they're a dime a dozen. They're a dime for a million, you know.
Yeah.
And we only hook onto the ones we hook on.
And there's a question, Jeff, what's the difference between the Jeff prior to his conscious seeking phase and the Jeff today? If there is any difference, the only difference is I don't believe anything anymore. You know? What else? But Jeff, would you have ever understood any of this without meditating if you had only gone to Starbucks from the beginning? Only if I had had a skinny latte. That's the path to enlightenment. I mean, it's okay. Let's put it this way: I have no way of communicating this. People don't believe me. People don't believe this when I say this. Really has nothing to do with anything that I did or didn't do. This isn't an achievement. It's not an achievement. And you know, I could say that until I'm blue in the face, and people won't believe me, and they'll think I'm denying something, or I'm trying to be clever, or I'm, I don't know. All I can say is this is absolutely free, and it's available now, and there's no, it's available now for those who are open. I mean, radically open to it, for those who are open to this, for those who are willing to listen. I mean, really listen, and just move away, drop all of their preconceived ideas, everything they've read, everything that the teachers have said, all their cherished philosophies. People who are willing to look afresh at things, you know, and just really listen without prejudice. You know, if you're coming from knowledge, if you know that there's such thing as awakening, and that one day you're going to get awakened, and that then I can't, or that one day you're going to become enlightened, or if you believe enlightenment is a state, or that one day this energetic shift will happen, I won't stop you. All I can do is offer this other possibility. That's all I can do is offer this other possibility to those who are open to it. And I've never claimed to do or be anything else. That's all this is. It's a sharing, and people will listen or they will walk away, and that's it. And people will say, Jeff, you're a teacher. Jeff, you're a lousy teacher. I probably agree with them. Jeff, you're this. Jeff, you're that. Okay. I am what you say I am, and that's the freedom of this, you know. And that's my raspberry is the answer to everything, really. What's Jack saying? Jack, you should do a webcast. Jeff is like a god. Jeff is like a god, if you ask me, but if you ask him, he will just deny it because he is not a teacher. In his mind, he is just normal. That's so sweet, Jack. Jeff doesn't understand this because it is not understandable, because it just is, but then even saying it is, it's beyond the point of non-duality. Jack, you are something special. Jeff, remember, will you buy me a beer? Yes, I'll buy you a beer.
Remember, Jeff, it's like 3 minutes past lights out.
Oh, yeah, Amy's back.
Uh-oh.
I think she needs her beauty sleep. It's past Amy's bedtime.
God, what She's a show, Jeff. What a beautiful show. I love it when you're reading the chat box, too, because sometimes it gets very interesting.
So lots of love to everyone. Thank you for your...
Oh, God, lots of love to you. Terrific.
Thank you for all your questions and your comments, everyone. And, yeah, I look forward to... Well, we'll see what happens in the future. Hopefully I'll be back and we can do it all again. Start from the beginning.
Absolutely.
If I don't get tired of it by then. But you'll find me in Starbucks.
Yeah. If you need. Yeah, we're going to do the next show from Starbucks, you know, because this is how we get to really get the answers that we've been waiting for, right?
Why not? Let's do it in Starbucks.
Let's do it.
Let's get rid of all this spiritual bullshit.
We're sure going to do it. I don't know. We could always go to jail or something like that.
A sign, we'll talk for coffee.
Yeah. We'll just put up a sign. He says, we'll talk for coffee.
That's all I ask. A little bit of coffee.
Okay, Jeff.
Guys.
We totally love you. You're so great.
You are too.
Okay. Bye-bye.
See you soon.